a list of waivers requested by the applicant to address some of the outstanding engineering issues. And I think that those things will be worked out either prior to endorsement or prior to building permit, so.
Okay. I saw those. I wasn't sure if engineering waited on them.
They did, yes.
Okay.
So.
Sure.
Hi, this is Brad Latham, and Jesse and Sarah are also with me. We've been doing quite well. I think we're talking to Pete Mead. Jack Sullivan, who's the project engineer. And I think one comment that you need to start with is the subdivision rules and regulations. I think when the PRD was created, it was envisioned so we'll take a piece of land and put a roadway into it that may not meet subdivision requirements and therefore need waivers and put new houses in the connections. This one's a little different. This one isn't really having a roadway at all. It's having a new driveway and a new house. So I think that the waivers, when we get to that stage and Jack can address them, make a lot of sense here with the lack of intensity. In our application, we tried to compare all of the sections of the zoning bylaw, the criteria, and outline how it met them. And I hope you comment to be some help and go through the process. I'm not sure you want us to go through all of them here, but probably 20 to 30 of them, but I believe that we meet the criteria, the crucial criteria for approval. If you want Jack to describe any particulars of it, but the only new feature here is a second home, which would be on a second lot, and will have its own driveway. And the backland, we provided with the package a draft homeowners association trust, just to be assured that the open space would stay as open space. And to the extent any maintenance is required, this is all natural, so it's probably not required, there is a requirement that the homeowners contribute towards any kind of maintenance costs. So that's pretty much the concept that we're pursuing. It's the same concept that you have found acceptable for at least two or three of the others in town over the years. We'd be more than happy to any questions you have. I think in essence, we've been through so much of this in the process, and the package I hope is complete to be able to provide the information you need to make a judgment in that regard. Thank you very much.
My name is Jack Sullivan, owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. Just to add on to what Brad said on this project, I'll give a quick overview. I think some members, a member I haven't seen before, but I haven't been in front of the board in a little while. But to qualify for a PRD, you need 60,000 square feet of land area. We have 2.4 acres out at this site, so we're well over the 60,000 square foot threshold. In some history as well, on the back corner of this lot, there's a wetland with a vernal pool. We went before the Conservation Commission. We filed an NRAD to lock in the location of those wetland flags. That was done. So we have an existing order of resource area delineation for this property. And the whole idea with this project was not to do any work within 100 feet of the wetlands. So where this is an open space style development, you want to try to protect existing land features, topographical features. You can see there's like a hill area here. There's a hill in the back. There's the wetland area. So this whole hatched area through here is all open space. So there'll be no proposed work within 100 feet of the wetland. As you know, Jesse Wilson's grandmother lives in the existing house. We're not proposing to do any work to that house whatsoever. There were some comments from engineering about running underground utilities like electric cable and telephone to the house, but what I basically look to seek is just everything for the new house will run underground utilities, new water, sewer, underground telephone, electric cable. They're basically looking to construct a Cape style single family home with a two-car garage. For drainage mitigation, I'm proposing porous pavement, and we're really only opening enough of the wooded area to get the driveway and utilities in. I leave a no-cut zone next to the Grayson property next door, 145 Van Norden Road. There'll be a 15-foot no-cut. I located two trees. They're private trees, the face of the trees, and they're about a foot onto private property. But I located those. The driveway will come in between those. And I believe we just really go with a minimum width driveway to get back to the structure. And you can see from their yard area, we really didn't leave. They do have two small children. They will have a backyard, but it's not an overly large backyard. And they're going to service with a propane tank. There'll be an underground propane tank for this. One of the PRD requirements is to have at least 40% open space. I think we're close to 50%. And another requirement, you do a proof plan showing how many lots you can get with a conventional subdivision. I show two. I've always made the case if I worked hard enough, I could probably show three, but there's no intention to try to get three lots out of this. I stated that at town meeting probably a year and a half ago. I think there'll be a restriction placed on this when I read through the draft order that there'd be no future subdivision. If there was, we'd have to go through this whole process again. And Jesse and Sarah have no intention of doing that. This is basically, they live in North Reading now. Jesse grew up in Reading. He'd like to get his family back into town. That's basically the history with it. A few of the waivers, one requirement under the subdivision control law is to locate all trees 6 inches or larger on the property. I asked for a waiver from this. This site is heavily wooded. Even you can barely see the existing house from the road. It would take probably 3 days of full surveying work to locate all the trees. And the reality is this whole area here is a no-cut, no-disturb area. It's all going to stay wooded. And they're only, as I said, they're only taking down limited trees to get the driveway, the house area, and a small yard area. So we're hoping we get a waiver on that. And there's also, and it's something I didn't notice, but the town engineer noticed it, saying any slopes in excess of 10% in your open space areas, you cannot have slopes greater than 10% in your open space. I didn't go through and do a calculation, but I might have some slopes in the open space area that are more than 10%. But you know, I wouldn't want to go in there and try to regrade them. I'd end up losing trees. I'd be bringing heavy equipment in. And the idea with our open space is just to leave it natural. There are some areas that are flatter that if people want to get out and use the open space, they can. But we didn't propose any like passive recreation areas. In some towns, I do a lot of work in Lexington lately, and this type of development is very popular in Lexington. They like the open space style developments. They're actually trying to incorporate like trail systems through some of these. For this size property, it doesn't make sense. I just permitted one in Lexington that was 12 acres, and we provided a trail system. I think that's probably why that requirement's in your bylaw, not to exceed 10%. But for this case, especially, we do have a vernal pool, and we don't want to do any work within 100 feet of the vernal pool, or I'd have to file with the Conservation Commission. They wouldn't be too happy with that. There were a few, one waiver that I didn't request, but Julie actually mentioned that we should discuss is, I didn't prepare a landscaping plan for this project, and I didn't request a waiver from it, but they're basically, you know, it's going to be landscaping that works with a single family home. We could show some mulch beds and plantings, unless the board feels really for one house lot, it's overkill. We're okay putting into a landscaping plan, but we're also okay if you think a waiver could be granted, or if we work with town staff on some sort of landscaping plan. And I'll turn it over to the board for any questions.
I'd be okay with waiving the landscape plan. It's their home. I can't imagine they're going to just leave it all bare. It's also how many hundred feet away from the street line. I don't think you'll ever see it.
Yeah.
The only comment I would make is that really try to protect that no-cut area at the beginning and those two trees, because contractors, they get real happy with those bulldozers sometimes and just come in and start clearing without paying attention. It's happened on a few other projects that have come, a few other regular PRDs, and mm-hmm. I'd really try to make sure you protect that.
Yeah.
Those are the comments I had.
In the same vein, the if there are the 6-inch or larger trees, which you know are going to come down, it would be nice to see those identified. And those, along with the waiver for enumerating the entire property, it would be nice to see the semi plan for the larger trees that will be coming down as part of the landscape work.
I agree with that, Mr. Tuttle. That's anything within the work area that we're going to take down, I can identify. I think that would be a fair compromise. That makes sense.
Good.
And then also, if there's some larger trees in this area that I don't designate as a no cut, I they want to leave a wooded buffer as well. So if I locate some existing trees and there's some larger trees along this lot line, I'll show them so that we maintain a natural buffer to the neighbor.
Good.
Comment about the new water line, is that a requirement of the PRD or is that just a request of engineering? The new water line to the old house?
That was just a request from the engineering department.
Okay.
Wasn't a requirement of the PRD, but it might be an old water service. I didn't look into the year of it, but they wanted the water service and the utility, the overhead utilities underground to the existing house, but
okay.
More of a question. It says in here the engineering division would like a new schematic plan that meets the requirements of preliminary subdivision plan. What's that?
I'm requesting a waiver from that. They,
right. I guess what's the schematic plan that's required?
I'll let Julie or Jean answer. Do you want to answer it or you
no,
want?
No, I mean, I wasn't actually sure if they meant a new proof plan or a new preliminary plan, but I felt like that ship had sailed.
Yeah.
So.
It's already been approved.
Yeah, I guess that's what I was.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Julie and I kind of scratched our heads on that one.
I mean, we had a preliminary plan in front of you. I think
right.
that when I read George's comments or the engineering department's comments, I took it as they wanted me to do a full-blown preliminary plan showing, like typically, I know I reference Lexington, but typically in Lexington I show a right-of-way and how many lots I can create. I show frontage area, I
right.
show what I could do, but I don't get into a full-blown design. I looked at the request of the engineering department to show all utilities, grading, like basically, you know, maybe some preliminary drainage, and it just seemed overkill for what we're dealing with here.
All right. Yeah, great. Although that does raise the question, when you try to use the PRD for something so small, do you open up a can of worms of requirements that you're then going to be held to somewhere?
I think a conceptual plan was given early on, too, that mm-hmm. showed the possibility of two or three additional lots.
Yep.
Or if it really was a concern when we filed our preliminary PRD, if the comments came up at that time,
right.
then we would have dealt with it more. They didn't come up at that time, and it only came up with this definitive
right.
submission.
Right, keep that in mind. If it comes through again, a similar project, mm-hmm. small, to get all these waivers up front,
mm-hmm.
all these requests.
Yep.
Okay, so do we have to vote on each of the waivers?
I think you could, if you go through them and you all agree that they're acceptable, you could just add waivers into your motion.
Okay.
You know, including all waivers or something like that in your motion.
All right.
Okay. So I think we should make a note somewhere. I guess it's the waiver number 3. The applicant will provide what we discussed.
Oh.
For the tree locations?
Tree locations in the work area, if you will.
For lot 2.
Yeah.
And that would be I guess prior to building permit?
Except it's the opposite of this, right?
Right.
You're asking for which trees to be removed.
I can do it prior.
You're asking which trees will be removed as opposed to which trees will be saved.
Right.
So you want a tree removal plan?
For lot two.
Okay, so, and Jack agreed to do it prior to endorsement. Which means you'll get to see it.
And I guess that begs the question about the public shade trees. I mean, public shade trees are just those that are within a certain distance, I don't know how far that is, from the roadway, right? So if you're out there sort of identifying which trees you're gonna cut, would that be that? And you're gonna do a plan anyways that has that. Can you just add which trees are public shade trees that are gonna, and presumably those are gonna stay?
Yeah.
So that, you know, sort of minimize the number of.
Then we have a record of it. I know that's fine. I'm fine doing that.
Since I think that can all be put together on that one plan without a big lift.
That's fine.
So we've modified number three and deleted number four, correct?
Yep.
Correct. Number three. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
What we had agreed to was instead of identifying all the trees, because they have that a big no-cut area, they'd identify the trees, the larger trees that they are.
Oh, okay.
Sort of the inverse. And while they're doing that plan, they can identify the public shade trees.
Got
it. That on there.
Okay.
Everything else. We haven't discussed modifying anything else from this draft decision.
No.
You want to keep running with this one?
I think we're all set, unless
there's
anything else.
Did you open it?
Is there any public comment regarding this project?
Okay. Move that the CPDC approve the final plan review decision for the PRD at 149 Van Norden Road as amended.
With all waivers? As amended?
Including all waivers.
Including the waivers as enumerated, yes.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? Abstain. There we go.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you. Very well done.
Next up on the agenda, site plan review, minor modification for the perimeter fence material at Art of Senior Living, 1100 Main Street. Hi, how are you?
I'm Angelina Rotella. I'm a project coordinator with Art of Senior Living, so I have largely been working behind the scenes on this project. So this is my first time actually in running for you guys. done last year, and we're just about 7 months in. And as part of that, our contractor has identified an alternative material for our fencing. So it is largely the same in terms of design. It's just the slats that are 7 feet, and again, the lattice, which was previously approved. However, this would be vinyl instead of pressure-treated wood. And we have seen this as a developer many times before. This is largely because of durability, and also over time, it just is a little bit more aesthetically pleasing. So really, it's just a change that prevents ongoing maintenance in terms of, and we've seen a lot in Florida, this is actually required by the jurisdictions because of pests that are prevalent there. As the wood starts to warp and rot and you replace it, you get this discoloration, and they really hate that. So vinyl is sort of what they're all going towards, and this is purely just a material change request. So I did bring it up today, and I'll turn it over to you guys if you have any questions, but happy to pass that around as necessary. Okay.
So is that the color, or is it going to be white?
No, it is. So it looks white on the screen, but it's really just a filtering thing. That is the color. It is a beige almond color. It just photographs to look more white than it is. I'm not sure why.
Okay. Any?
To be honest with you, I don't remember it being wood. I think I assumed it was vinyl.
Yeah, I think I did too.
That's a good thing.
But it will have the lattice work time?
It will, yes. Okay. So there's nothing in terms of the 7 feet and the 1 foot of lattice at the top. All of that is exactly identical as it was before. It's truly just the material that's changed.
Any questions, concerns?
I didn't remember the height being 7 or 8 feet. Yeah, I mean, normally our 6 foot is the benchmark. And there's a comment of it somewhere in our zoning bylaws.
I pulled Exhibit A directly from the approved site plan, which references that 7 foot fence with a 1 inch lattice. So that's
decision specifies it as 8 feet, like
okay.
She's described.
As I say, I mean, it was just a matter of not remembering.
Sure.
I know from the site, familiarity with the site, it's perfectly reasonable in terms of scale,
yes.
Especially along the rear part where the land adjoining the lots go up higher.
Anybody, are you here for this project?
Yeah.
Do you have any?
We got butters.
Okay. Do you have any questions, concerns, comments?
Now, in terms of the fence, it's going to say basically 8 feet.
Yes.
Now, it's going to be abutting our property pretty much from Anson Lane all the way down to Main Street, pretty much.
So, nothing has changed in
yeah.
terms of the layout. So, it's exactly identical to what
yeah.
it was before. So, it's just the product itself that's changing. So, what we were approved for previously in terms of the fencing is exactly the same. It's
well,
just the material.
Why is the change to the economic? Why is, why is, why is the change now?
It, for the material, it was purely just durability. So, it was a suggestion that Delbrook Scanlon, who's our contractor for the project, suggested.
Okay.
And a lot of times it's based really on aesthetics. So usually when you have a pressure treated wood fence, as you start to maintain it, there can be warping and rotting, and you don't usually replace the entire fence at one time. You replace it board by board as they start to rot. And so you can imagine there's some discoloration in terms of weathering as that occurs. So the newer wood pieces look new and the older wood pieces look old. And so this is a way to prevent that. It virtually cleans itself in terms of rain, though we do have maintenance provisions to clean it as well. But it doesn't require the same amount of maintenance, even though it costs more upfront. It's more durable in the long run.
Now, are they going to clean both sides? Like, I know, like, mold.
Of course,
mold?
Yes. And it would be the same maintenance that we would have to do on the fencing as well in terms of cleaning. But we would absolutely be cleaning both sides, yes.
Can you say your name and address
yeah.
for the record?
Oh, Willie Chin, living in Anson Lane, Reading, Mass.
Is it also on the other side of the property, like on 1102? So
So I have the chain link fence right now. Is that fence going the whole length of my driveway also?
So it goes all the way around the perimeter from the outside. So I can show you, I actually have a site plan that I can share with you. So it is still going all the way around here. Yep, all the way around here and all the way up front. And again, this is because we cater to Alzheimer's and dementia residents, so they have to have a fully secure ending here, that little inlet, so my property is here, so it will come up my driveway. Absolutely not, no. So it's, and this is, again, exactly what was approved in 2013.
This came up, right.
So it starts, it begins where these dumpsters are in here, and then it goes all the way around to the back. And then this is, I'm sorry, this is also fencing, it's existing fence, yes.
Existing fence on your property, on 1082 Main Street, and.
So, I'm sorry, one second, only because protocol is for you to address your questions to the board, and then we can work with you. But I mean, no, I think we're at a point where we can have our vote, but you can at least have, you can continue having your conversation outside. I don't want to hold up anybody else that's here for subsequent items on the agenda.
Can you ask them to, if they signed in or?
Yeah, and folks, if you haven't already signed in, please make sure you do. Okay, great, thank you.
So I live at 1082 Main Street, which abuts, so if you're looking at the project, I'm on the house on the left.
Okay.
And according to these, so you say everything's the same, but according to what I saw originally, this is not the same. So it says existing fence here. That existing fence is on my property. And I was told that that existing fence is coming down because Artis wanted to do the fence. They do not want the fence on our property, that you wanted on your fence, on your property. And the fence on my property was coming down and going on your property. And it was also discussed that, so if I'm coming out of my driveway, it can't be 8 feet because you cannot see Main Street to go onto my driveway. So it was going to be going, you know, a little less high.
Okay, this plan, this construction set is exactly what was approved. So I'm happy to take my questions back for you, but this truly hasn't changed at all.
Because I don't see a fence. So you're saying now that the existing fence is going to be on my property and ours is not going to have a fence on that side?
The fencing will be exactly as it was when it was initially approved. So again, happy to take those questions back, but.
And I'll look to see if I have what the original stated.
Can I see what you're looking at?
Yeah.
Is she here?
Yeah. So this is the existing stockade. But then right next to it is the 7 foot.
I have multiple copies of that.
It's just a addition.
Yeah, that'd be helpful.
Yeah, what she's saying is this should start.
Jeff.
And then also there's.
The extents of the fence seem to match.
Yes.
What that plan was that we're looking at. I think what we're saying here is that this should start to drop down, right? So, you know, the fence should kind of come down.
Is it May 23rd?
In front of 13.
2013?
Well, that's the existing fence. That's her fence. That's hers.
So you all want to and have to have the fence on your property. Whether it's likely, you know, whether they were scoped out to have a fence all the way around their property. In your condition, you have an existing fence. I don't know whether you put it up or whether the former. So it's one of those things, it's on your property, they need a fence on their property.
They said they were going to take down our fence.
It's always sort of funny to have.
Well,
two fences right next to each other, although sometimes you want that because you want to control your own fence.
No.
So
that wasn't the plan. We have our fence, and then there's landscaping. There's $5,000. Artists had us meet a their landscaper. There's $5,000 worth of landscaping. Here's my fence. Here's the landscaping. And Iris said, what do you want to do with the landscape? And we said, we want to keep it. They said, we're going to take down the fence that's on your property. We want the fence on our property. But according to this, this isn't what it's saying here.
When did that conversation happen?
That had to have happened.
You know what, my husband, who's at work right now, when we were all here. So it was the original person.
Was it Jay Hicks?
Yeah.
Jay Hicks.
Okay.
I mean, this doesn't say. We met the landscaper. I couldn't tell you, two years ago, was it? Was that when we originally started?
It was two years ago in 2013.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, I can't speak to that. But I do know that this, what I'm showing you is identical to what was there before.
I think
so.
What we can do here is we can vote on the change to the material, to the material of the fence. I would request that you work with, I'm sorry, I didn't catch you. Yes, work with her and her family to resolve this question. If we need to come, if you need to come back and do another, I don't know, is there a way we can account for that without having to have them come back before us? Or is that something that we would want to?
Well, it'd be administrative.
I could probably do that administratively.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
If they come to an agreement.
Okay.
It's different than what's shown on the plan.
If I could add, though, the fence limits that they are showing are what you described. Your fence is also shown. It's just not shown being removed.
Yes, and that's the question.
So it's a question of the removal of your existing fence.
Yes, and the, landscaping. And landscaping there.
On your side.
On
your
side.
On your side of the fence.
On my property. And we had, we actually had everything surveyed, and we had stakes put in before you began. Because my property was used when Eric's, my property was hot-topped, and it was said it would all be fixed once a new person came. So I made sure before you started that Middlesex survey from North Reading came and put stakes in. Of course, those stakes are gone now, some of them. So if I, and my husband even asked the supervisor, I don't know his name, do I need Middlesex to come back?
Yeah.
Because it does jet out, it's not straight across. So if we need Middlesex to come back out, I will have them come.
Okay, sure, and I'm happy to work with you guys on that.
Okay, good, good.
Okay.
And I would take into consideration the fact that you want to step down those last few sections so that there is a clear sight line for the roadway.
Sure.
Should we incorporate that into this?
Yes.
Decision.
You can't enforce any side deals.
No, but we can, the stepping down.
Yes.
So that's different from the original site plan approval. Then are you changing what was
already?
Well,
it doesn't really say what's happening to the end section.
Okay.
But,
we're discussing that.
I do
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
I mean, if
yeah,
it's not
I
in the site plan, we'll get
plan.
It in.
Yeah.
Discuss it for Criterion. I remember that.
We always discuss it when it comes up.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
And that is a very, that's a higher speed section of roadway than Criterion. Too.
Okay.
So you understand what we're describing?
I understand what you're describing,
sure. All right, so we're going to incorporate that into the decision as well.
Okay.
So it'll be a change of the material and then kind of that slope or step down as you approach.
How much length?
What have we done?
Well, at least eight feet.
You need it from wherever the stop line is of the driveway.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's got to be a stop line, so you've got to do it from the stop line.
Yeah,
can't be higher than 4 feet.
And back to the.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. It's usually 1 8-foot section of fence that gets.
Yes. Yeah. So it'd be 4 feet high to 8 feet high. From the 4 feet has to be as far back as the stop line.
Mm-hmm.
And then transition up to 8.
So that's behind the right-of-way, behind the right-of-way. That's some distance behind the sidewalk.
Yes. And it's hard to know without seeing what the pavement
mm-hmm.
plan is, because I don't know, you don't know where that exactly is.
Right.
We'll add that as a condition.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Anything else on this? How's the project going overall?
It's going well, yeah.
Yeah.
We've been lucky in terms of weather. We're actually still on course, so that's great. And we're slated for an opening in the first quarter of next year.
Oh, good, okay.
Do you want a condition that she's going to work with your butter?
I don't know that we can.
What does that give us? Does that?
Why not?
I don't know. How do you give us? That's a side thing.
Yeah.
They agreed to.
And then they provide like a report to me in a few months.
Well, we could.
It
it's probably a finding. And it's basically the artist has agreed to work with.
Okay, a finding
the neighbor.
Works. Sure.
Yeah. That's probably cleaner.
Yeah. Are we going to make that clear as it relates to the original site plan approval?
I'm sorry.
That will work with them as it relates to the original site plan approval.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Tony DeRosso, 130 John Street. I'm looking at what's on the website for the plans. And I don't see where the post fence went down to Main Street.
What year is that?
I don't know. It's the one on the website.
For today's meeting packet information?
No, this was on the website for pre-approved plans.
Okay.
And what it shows is the fence basically goes down and connects to the building, doesn't come all the way down to Main Street.
Oh, it's on the north side.
Oh, and this is in the same.
Yeah,
plan.
It's the other side.
Just looking at it. Right there, see?
You can't look. It's proposed foot fence.
If the wording is right inside the trees. It's parallel to the fence.
Okay, yeah.
So there's actually two issues that I need addressed here. One is the fence, and two is to make sure artist knows where the property line is. There's two issues.
Okay.
Yep.
Not one, two.
Okay.
Tony, are you good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
You ready for a motion?
Yeah, it actually does look like it doesn't go all the way down. It looks like it's the fence was supposed to stop right in there. Right, it looks like it almost goes down the center line of those trees, but not quite.
No, not the center line. No, it's there. Proposed.
Yeah,
I think it's the
that's
dark line. Yeah.
No, the dark line is the property line.
No.
Here's the fence.
No, follow the fence up. It's the darker line.
That's the darker line.
Yeah, no, it's this one.
Yeah.
See how it jogs,
it's
jogs here
one.
And then
yeah.
back.
Yeah. It stops here. But it does say proposed
fence.
So we need to get a clearer.
Well, also this mark.
The main thing.
This goes to.
This is never the work with your butter.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the work with your butter to resolve that issue of where the fence is and what the fence is, whose fence is where.
Well,
yeah.
Work with your butter to ensure that there's adequate sight lines.
Yeah, but that has nothing to do with the abutter. The adequate sight lines has to do with the people leaving the.
Well, except that the abutter's driveway is much closer to the property line than his artist.
Yeah.
So it is, in fact, their sight line which is of the concern.
True.
Now, the artist has got a good 12 feet or more from the driveway to the
Correct.
Fence.
Correct. No.
Right now, it's vague, and we have no. There's nothing on this construction plan that says what they're doing.
Yeah.
right? It just shows it right to the property line, and I'm suggesting that we bring it back.
It should be back there.
Should be back.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's really just, this is two ways, right? Or at least
yep.
It was there.
Mm-hmm. This has the fence going all the way to the sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
Then yeah, they should. Is that what
but
we're seeing?
No, you can't.
They can't have it going all the way to the sidewalk.
Right.
No, and that's why I'm saying use the property line as a reference point and say the last section is 8 feet from the property line.
Okay. I'm fine with that.
You okay with that?
What did you say? I'm sorry.
What I want to do is I want to tell them to stop the fence 8 feet from that property line on Main Street. Because that'll give you 8 feet to the property line, probably another 8 feet of sidewalk width. That's about 16 feet of sight line down Main Street as you come out of your driveway. Unless you think that you're bothered by the very end of their drive visually.
Went right down.
Height or chain length?
It was wood.
Yeah,
so
it's
six.
Getting destroyed now.
And that gives you good sight
line? What happened was it went down,
oh,
they brought it down, and then the snow plow took the little section. So we
but did
it,
so it went down
it
to
went
like
down.
4 feet?
Yes, it
yeah.
went down. So that
out
when
to
you
the
come,
side.
You can see
okay.
out.
So then that works.
So and now that had worked
yes.
to you to have it 4
okay.
feet and then transition
yes.
over.
I withdraw my
all right.
motion.
Okay.
We just wanted to make sure you could see.
Yes.
Okay.
So this is the
yeah.
plan.
Mm-hmm. All right. So two conditions. One is the material of the fence. Two is curving it down the last 8 foot section. And then a finding regarding artists working with the abutter to resolve this open question.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Property lines and so forth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, then.
Yep.
Move that the CPDC approve the minor modification decision for the site plan at 1100 Main Street, Artist Senior Living, as amended.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Be
here.
Thanks.
Thank you. All
right.
Pass around. Can I grab that plan back that we passed around?
Oh, that's right.
There we go.
Thank you. All right, next up on the agenda are working group updates. Awesome. All right, so we had our 40R expansion downtown rezoning workshop recap. How do we want to do this? Julie, do you want to provide us with just a kind of a brief overview of?
Sure. So I was able to go through all the feedback that we got last week, and I put together sort of a summary of it for you. So the first page, the question was what areas should be prioritized. And I looked at which areas were given a 1 sticker, which were given a 2 sticker, and which were given a 3 sticker, and then I added them all up. And then I totaled, so I didn't just take the ones that got 1 and say that's 1. I looked at the ones that got the most of 1, 2, mm-hmm. or 3. And that was how I figured out what area should be priority 1, priorities 1 through 5. So from that, if you agree with that strategy, area 3 had the most 1, 2, or 3 votes. As the area to prioritize. And then area 5 and then area 2. And then as you go through the packet, I just summed up like the yeses and nos that were put on the posters for our different options that we provided. And then in terms of like what types of uses are appropriate, where they use those R, B, and M stickers, mm-hmm. I just kind of summarized because, you know, they stuck them wherever. So I said, okay, if it looks like it's on the west side of Linden, then that's, you know, one residential use could go there. And then I looked at how many tables felt the same way to try to get some idea of consensus. So this is the best way I could figure out of how to congeal the information. And then I figured you guys could kind of figure out if you want to try to bite off anything this year or do a little more outreach and work on it for next year.
Has the subcommittee, has your subcommittee met at all since April 9th?
Not since the public forum.
Okay. What kind of timing are we looking at again? I saw it in your papers.
Pretty soon.
Yeah, we really kind of have to wrap it up because we're looking at the public hearings in July.
Mm-hmm.
So there's really only a couple of more meetings to get stuff done. Bring it back here for discussion.
You were feeling the urge to work this hard?
It needs both the urge and the opportunity. The Main Street corridor, I think that the priorities that were identified are, in fact, very good ones. You know, looking at the Haven Street to the railroad track should, in fact, be a priority. Whether we can come up with something in time for the November meeting is more of a challenge.
Right.
Come up with something that can be voted on.
Mm-hmm. Right. Because it's basically what we're looking at would be probably an overlay district.
They liked. We had 18 yeses for creating an overlay district.
Yeah. Well, which is an indication, and it came across clear, that the existing overlay that we have, which is the 40R, doesn't fit that area, which is, you know, a good assessment of the situation. We also, we fed in the suggestion about going to something like Business A, which is the commercial in the roadway strip, if you will. And that got...
No one commented on that.
Yeah. Nobody thought that that was a particularly good idea.
Or a bad idea.
Well, true. Parking is clearly the biggest challenge.
So when I look at this, it's information I think we can process, and Jean and her and mm-hmm. Julie can process because we're used to looking at it. But I don't know that anyone can read this and understand what it means.
Right.
I think we're better off showing them maps or graphics,
mm-hmm.
which are the reverse of this again. But colored blocks of map areas that say
mm-hmm.
this is the zone,
right.
and we're looking mm-hmm. at residential and that. So if we were to actually take all this data and build these graphics for town meeting, we could take sort of an informal vote with town meeting members. Do you agree with this approach? And that gets us buy-in potentially up front. We get to see what they think. They'll probably say yes. Maybe they won't be informed enough about it if they think it's not a real zoning change. But it sort of gets it in front of them in a visible, readable way. It gets it in front of the people who showed up in a visible, readable way. Maybe we get buy-in faster as we come up with the language, which will take a lot longer than to come up with a meeting, town meeting.
So you're saying like mock designs, like three-dimensional?
I don't know if I wanna go that far. I'm thinking flat plans.
Right.
You know, these guys put up these maps and people came on there with their stickers and they could tell by where the stickers were kind of what was going on. So now if we were to take, you know, colored areas of that, make it more readable, I can quickly scan through them.
Mm-hmm.
Here it is, this is the zone, these are the limits, this is potentially housing, this is commercial. It's an overlay district, it's not 40R, it is 40R.
Right.
Do something like that for town meeting, get everyone on board, and then try to write the stuff, because I don't see how we're gonna get it written. But it keeps it moving. And it takes, we don't lose this data, which is, you know, we spent some time collecting.
Right.
Certainly a lot of time collating it.
I was approached by an architect at that session on the 9th, and he didn't go so far as to volunteer, but I think he would kind of assist if we needed assistance with developing graphics and drawings and visuals of what South Main, or not South Main Street, but Main Street could look like if we move that forward towards an overlay.
I guess I don't think that we're there to put, I think it's better, given the stage we're at, to keep things in 2D.
Yeah.
Doing visuals before we really have a chance of vetting that out can backfire pretty significantly,
yeah,
I think. So,
we did that for South Main Street too. George and I did a lot of floor area ratio modeling.
Okay.
Very quickly, we can calculate that up real quick. I can model anything you want, but remember what happened when somebody tried to model the maxed out plan? They scared everybody.
What was that, the signage?
They just took everything, maybe five stories all the way down.
It was the, this is what your zoning, this is what you can do with the zoning that's in place, which isn't really true. Because it didn't take into account parking requirements, and it was literally setbacks and heights. And so you had this massing model of Main Street, which was not at all what anyone wants.
And where parking's already a concern.
Yeah.
So town meetings, we've been saying, oh, town meeting's right around the corner, but it's still a ways out, and we're talking about doing a presentation to town meeting with these drawings. Is there anything we can do in the interim? I mean, do we have, we can still do some work, obviously, but do we have another public forum similar to what we had last time and bring forth some of the, you know, kind of review this information and bring forth some potential ideas for how we could shape the Main Street corridor? Or do we hold off until town meeting?
You mean further the three priority areas, or one of the three priority areas, or just keep it open?
No, I think we'd want to hone in on where we're looking, or where what this data tells us.
Just take it the next step, regardless of where things are, town meeting wise. Forget town meeting's gonna happen.
Yeah.
Right.
Just okay. We did this. What's the next step of giving feedback to people, and then as much as we want to or can develop sort of the concepts of the first one or two priorities, and wherever we end up in terms of when we feel like it's ready to go to town meeting, then that will be the town meeting we go to.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because we can't rush this stuff.
No. I mean, we talked about vision statements, and is that a next step here to start developing what the vision statements are for these areas of priority?
Well, I think we got a pretty clear, I mean, the level of participation was wonderful.
Yeah.
And we got a clear answer for like the first three, you know, the area three, area five, area two. I mean, this is like exactly the right order to deal with the things. And for example, area three is the one where we've got the residential, the conformity, non-conformity kind of thing. Area two is the 40B, which is going on in parallel with this. to a certain extent. So that the, if we focus on the Main Street corridor, we got a pretty clear on area, on the priority four, area one, saying go ahead with the historic district. And that's something that, which is not necessarily this board. Basically make a recommendation to the Historic Districts Commission to take a look at that. Basically do nothing with the existing A40, the area four, if you will. So it basically says focus on the Main Street corridor issues. And that's, we do need a vision of some kind, need to get George's creativity, because it is a challenge. The residential neighborhood, Lincoln Street, the other side of the tracks, we're just going to have to keep an eye on the 40B and see what happens.
Right.
If we can come up with something, competing vision, it would be nice, but I'm not sure that we have anything any ideas to work with there, other than extending the A40. Am I making any sense on that?
Well, I think you're right. We should probably, if I understood you correctly, focus our energy on Area 3. Maybe, I don't know, how does that work? Pass Area 1 to the Historic District Commission and say, hey, we collected some information on this. You may want to consider this for as another historic district. I don't know what the protocol is for that, but.
Yeah, I don't understand what the protocol is. We should certainly pass the information along to them.
I wonder if one way of going at this would be to, in this summary format, maybe make a presentation to the Board of Selectmen.
Mm-hmm.
As they were very interested in, you know, at one of the meetings, they were reporting it out.
It's a great idea.
And that's a public forum. So whatever you present, it'll be televised, and it can continue to summarize the findings of that meeting and open up the dialogue with the Board of Selectmen in terms of, you know, any input they might have before any definitive direction is taken.
And I like the approach Nick brought up of taking this 2D with maps to try and sort of define, like, this is what we heard in this area, this is what we heard here, this is off the table sort of thing.
Yeah, the next level of detail on the 2D is important.
Yeah.
So are you saying merge those two ideas? So take Nick's and...
Yeah, use Nick's idea of what we would
format.
Do, but do make that presentation to the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Love it.
And
that makes sense.
Yeah, and not necessarily to town meeting.
Sure, not yet, anyway.
We'll take something to town meeting, but we'll keep it rolling. And
Yeah, and then I think the board would... I would assume the board would have a lot of interest in this in terms of what direction, and they might offer some good thoughts on next steps and best path forward. I mean, there's a lot happening. You know, this is a super busy time. There's meetings at least once and sometimes twice a week coming up in the month of June for listening sessions with the community to talk about the override. So to have another public meeting in June on its own feels like it just might not be the best timing. But going to the Board of Selectmen in June might be great, and then get a better feel for it. And then they're continuing to wind their way through the process of the override.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's summer, and then everyone's back in September. Maybe there's an opportunity to bring it back to CPDC in September and kind of take the pulse of next steps. And by that point, you'll have probably some really good feedback.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's the right time to do that? You said June. That feels a little.
June, there's five meetings in June, but there are Board of Selectmen meetings, yeah?
I'm sorry.
There's five community meetings spread out, like, say, you know, between June 1st and the end of June, listening sessions, and the zoning board is going to continue, and I would assume the 40B project's going to continue into June. So it's going to be a busy time right up until the 4th of July with all these different meetings.
Why don't we target mid-July, then, to go see them?
That's possible, yeah.
What do you guys think? Does that take the foot off the gas too much?
Yeah, I mean, there's nothing wrong with going in June before the Board of Selectmen.
Does July get us any public attention? They're already gone, not watching the Board of Selectmen meetings. I know everybody watches those.
Yeah, maybe it's better to go when kids are still in school.
Yeah.
I DVR them.
I would tend to go for the, towards the end of June, like six or eight weeks from now.
That's cool. We could do that.
Yeah.
So can you work to get us on one of the agendas?
Do they meet on the 28th?
I think so. I don't have that.
Do you own those agendas?
The Board of Selectmen, I don't remember them off the top of my head.
Oh, okay.
We can check the website.
Yeah, that's fine. No problem.
Do you guys like the new website, by the way? Isn't it beautiful?
Can't zoom in as far as you used to be able to in the GIS.
That is true.
It is.
I will bring that up with Kim. I have noticed the same thing.
Tell Kim to get on it.
Nick's bothered.
Messing me up. I need to get in deep.
They don't list them. It's just like now.
Actually, it's like that throughout.
Do they have a schedule?
Communities that are on GIS.
Actually, I've looked for this before and I've not found it, so I don't know.
Just not able to zoom in.
Meeting minutes? No.
That's weird.
More and more stuff is online, and more and more won't let you use your full screen area. As you say, you can't zoom in, you can't make pictures, full page, you can't do, I mean. They want you to be looking at eight things at the same time, and it's just.
It's kind of blank.
No, thank you.
That's funny, because when I go upstairs tonight, where my GIS people are.
So she doesn't post on there.
Really?
She
usually does
it 2 days before. That's awesome. Full labs full of people working on GIS.
Oh, yeah.
She waits till like 48 hours to actually bring it down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Just because their agendas change.
Yeah, they're always getting stuff added.
They're always getting stuff in.
Yeah.
All right, well, we can work on the dates in June.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need to start getting this data transferred.
Do you know if the dates are available online?
No.
Okay, that's fine. Don't worry about it. We'll figure it out. Tomorrow is soon enough.
So how does this intersect with the email that I think only Jean and I got about the 6/22 business community meeting?
That is something that Julie and I have been working with the chamber and some folks in the business community to have a after-hours meeting with the business community to talk about zoning, probably mostly signs, but certainly this could be part of it as well. And you might recall that we had such a great response from doing a format not in town hall, but at the bank, hosted by the bank, that business folks could come in at the close of business and just breeze in and out for an hour, hour and a half. We actually got comments from them. We circulated survey forms, and we got a lot of feedback, and we just did kind of a quick and dirty of, you know, what was going on, just broad brush, and it worked out really well when we were doing the zoning work back in 2014, 15. So we thought that might be a nice format to try, just so that we're sure that we've got the attention of the business community on something as important as signs.
Okay, so that was more around signage.
Well, it was more around a check-in with the business community at a time that might be convenient for them in a format that might be better for them, as opposed to one of the other ways that we do public meetings.
Okay, that sounds good.
Whatever they want to talk about, really, but.
Okay, let's come back. We'll come back to that in a second. It seems like we've got a good plan forward, or at least the immediate next step.
Yep.
For the zoning work.
Mm-hmm.
So you guys will work on getting us on an agenda.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And then once we know that, maybe in our next meeting, we can talk about how, what we want to present, how we want to present it.
Yep.
Okay. Any other questions or comments on the zoning prioritization work? Okay.
Yeah, I can help you with graphics and when you start getting into this.
Okay, great.
Great.
All right, sign bylaw. Looks like you guys have been busy.
Well, between Tony and Mary Ellen and Julie's hard work, this thing is really moving.
And then, of course, Nick's been very helpful as well.
Modest Nick.
I make all my sarcastic comments and then they get... a lot of work.
Good. Not
thank
really.
You.
I don't think so.
So we've kind of gone through the definitions. We've tried to comply with the new laws. And we've taken as much liberty as we can with that using Alito's rules, right, the examples that he laid out. And we still have some questions that will probably have to come in front of the attorney at some point, our attorney. Clarify some things, but in the markup that you see here, there are some comments that say things like ask the board or discuss with the board. Mm-hmm. Those are the parts where we probably need some input. I'm trying to see which ones we had here. So we've gone through the definitions. We've added this preamble, which is softer language than what we had before. Ours seemed a little mm-hmm. harsher. And then we've added this section for navigating the bylaws, give people sort of a step-by-step. This is what you should do, 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, before you start building your sign. We at one point toyed with having the table, you know, the table which summarizes all the dimensional mm-hmm. criteria up front, but it works better in the back. The one thing we're working on now is how to make that more legible. Maybe there's more white space in here. Some of these sign types go away. One of the ways we're dealing with content versus, well, the content issue is by having a lot of temporary signs, real estate signs, right? Yard
yeah.
sale signs, other signs like that. So you have a lot of temporary signs, and we'll just enumerate how many you can have in any district.
So you've made it through the full sign bylaw.
We've
not really.
We've tried to clean it up before we start making changes.
Okay.
Before we start making changes.
And the cleanups don't really, they go to like section, the full cleanups go through like temporary, which is section 825, I think. And then after that, we haven't really given a lot of focused attention. Sorry, it goes through prohibited. We haven't really talked as a group about what to keep and what to, we've gone through and like highlighted things that should be taken out because of the new ruling, and then we've added language that complies with the IMLA bylaw, but we haven't actually really talked about it much.
Is this, Nick, you, on page 7, we should discuss size and height requirements. We should just, page 7, is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, we're talking about what all these sizes are, how big the signs are. And I kind of stressing this idea about one way to sort of reduce the size of signs on Main Street, for example, is to allow them the 2 signs, which you know I've always been opposed to because there was never discussion about reducing the primary sign from 50 square feet, which is huge. And so I started writing down some language of things like, you know, you might be allowed 2 signs if neither one is larger than 24 square feet. So now we're down to 48, but the primary big sign is down by half, you know. And it gives the business is something that they've always been talking about, which is, you know, wanting another sign on these single lot, single business entities. They want something on their building as well. So you'd give them a choice. They could have the two, they could have one.
Yeah.
But it takes the big size down. So that's something we may want to talk about.
I think that's a good compromise.
We don't want to create a lot more nonconformance, I guess.
Right.
But there's nothing enticing them to reduce the size of that sign. And the e-car sign always bothers me every time I drive by that sign. Not e-cars anymore.
Holy cow.
So big. Yes, it's even worse.
Ebola, E. coli?
Yeah.
That one?
I don't know. No. Are they on TV? What, on like the public channel? Oh, sorry.
There is a comment that I found on page 4 where it says to be discussed with full board. And this is that whole off-premises sign definition. It's a huge, it's a can of worms that Nick can
I don't know, maybe this has to do with billboards, right? We want to make sure that we're not doing anything about not changing what we've agreed to do with billboards, which is basically prohibit them.
So we have the two definitions because we couldn't decide which one we liked better. Even though they're substantially similar, we left the second one in because, and we felt like we couldn't make the decision without talking to the group. Remember exactly.
Yeah, so the first one was the off-premises sign definition, I think, that we had. And the second one, I added the IMLA language into it. The may or may not, is that what it is? Why is this one different?
Well, that may or may not is talking about leasing. It's not talking about whether it's on the premises or not. Before it's...
Well, you've got the signs affixed to vehicles.
We added that last meeting because we started
to that's why
think
it's
about
not
what's going on there. I don't even know how we enforce that yet.
Yeah.
Because if we're going to push shared parking, it's potential that some businesses renting spaces for their vehicles, as opposed to, say, blatantly leaving your got junk truck, whatever it is,
yeah,
you know, in that one spot there. I'm not going to read this again to figure out why it is we want both, or why both are here.
Okay, so the second one with the IMLA stuff basically replaces an explanation of, explains what off-site means.
Mm-hmm.
It says, commercial use is not sold, manufactured, or distributed on or from the premises, which is basically an expansion of
mm-hmm.
the off-site.
Yep.
Either one, I mean, they say essentially.
You know what?
I think the second one is.
I think the first one got changed.
I think the second one is more comprehensive, and
yeah.
It also doesn't, like, in the first one, we define off premises with the words off site, which is not really helpful.
Right.
So.
Well, is attracting, directing attention to other commercial or non-commercial activity, is that content-based? first one?
It is. Our attorney would tell us it is because you have to read the sign to
determine what it is.
But the second one uses language, again, from IMLA, which uses these terms like outdoor advertising.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's fair to include that stuff.
Right.
Any sign which directs attention to goods, products, services, or commercial uses which are not sold, manufactured, distributed on or from the premises. I mean, that is the off-premises sign, the definition of it. And you have to read the sign in order to understand that, what it means, and you're allowed to do that. If you read the commentary in IMLA about that one, it says that the Supreme Court was in no way stipulating that you couldn't make that determination.
Right.
See, this is why this work of this group is taking so long, because it's
okay.
There's no easy decisions. Everything is weighed.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was actually in the fourth draft of the IMLA's version where they came up with this extra language.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't even say it in the third draft.
So I'm curious, so this says that by definition a sign affixed to a vehicle is an off-premises sign, even if it's on...
Well, not when it's on the premises, but when it's off the premises. If you park your truck with big sign on it, nowhere near your business, nowhere near where you're providing a service, it's essentially a portable sign, right? I mean, it's a sign. It's not functioning as your vehicle that you're going to use because you're not parked at your business. It's not parked at your home. Again, that's the tricky one, but... It's acting as a sign, not acting as a vehicle. You're not performing service there. You know,
we
talk about these plumbing trucks, but he's not working in that building. His
Maybe
office
they have
is not
some
located.
Major
there.
Plumbing issues.
As far as I know.
Every day.
Between the hours. So
yeah, 3 in the morning.
I mean, 5
a.m.
I understand the. something that we want to be able to regulate. Which means that we have to be able to articulate it.
Mm-hmm.
But it also raises the question of whether it's an easy challenge.
That's why it's flagged.
Okay.
We may discuss this right up until the end and then pull it if we feel we can't resolve it.
The signs effect affixed to vehicles.
Yeah, and whether that's the right term, is it more portable sign? You know, there are vehicles that are meant to carry signs, right? Is that, that's probably something we can regulate, portable signs.
Hmm. The trucks that are wrapped, it's a little bit of a stickier. Or box vans.
Exactly. That's the thing. That's your vehicle that you use for business, but you're just parking it someplace that makes it obvious. People can see it.
Mm-hmm.
How do you regulate that? So in the IMLA on outdoor advertising, it says the definition is content-based under literal interpretation of read, as it requires one to determine from reading or looking at the sign if a product is being advertised that is not sold on the premises. However, based on concurring opinion of Justice Alito and opinions of Kagan and Breyer, to say that the majority of the court would reach a conclusion that defining outdoor advertising or off-premises amounts to a content-based restriction seems a stretch.
Yep.
Yeah.
So by that, I think we can define outdoor advertising and off-premises and use it to control those things that we don't want. Billboards, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I mean, right. I'm more and more conscious of these flapping banners, the flexible, whatever, lollipop signs, I guess it might be.
Teardrop.
Yeah.
Yeah. What do we call those? Do we call those anything?
They're teardrop signs. Teardrop banners.
One of the things that I believe the decision permits is regulating the material of the sign.
Well, you can regulate temporary signs. You just can't regulate the content.
But I can also regulate the material of the sign.
What Dave's saying is we could say temporary signs shall not flap, shall have flexible material, shall have a frame all around. We could say it has to have a frame all around.
Or disallow flexible material.
And then when we can get a big fan, and when they come in for their permit, we can hold it up.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if flexible material is necessarily bad, because if you had a banner that was held from top to bottom, like if we hung them on our street posts or something, you know, that's not necessarily a bad thing. But those single wire teardrop signs are meant to move. They're an animated sign, really. Yeah. It's just animated by wind. It's the blow-up. It's the blow-up guy, right?
It's got animus.
It's got animus.
Well, you're talking about the ones that are fixed into the ground, and it's a kind of a vertical sign, right?
Like this.
Or, I mean, it might be a line of flags on a rope, and it's okay if they're just red or white or blue, or if there's some, you know, geographical, you know, country flag.
Yeah.
But if it says, you know, Joe's Sail Yard, then it's not allowed. I mean, that sounds content-based to a certain extent, but it's as long as American flags and Mexican and all the other flags are separately treated, then could we disallow non-rigid sign material?
We can disallow a type of sign, because it doesn't matter what the content is. It could be come to church on Sunday, it could be serving breakfast, right? It doesn't matter. It's the type of sign. So that sort of single wire, flexible, flappy sign that Duncan and
Supercuts and
people like to put out there.
Ceilings.
We could prohibit that type of sign.
Okay.
Yep. Do we have that defined right now?
No, we don't. Probably we started talking about temporary signs and which ones we would allow, when we would allow temporary signs and how to enumerate those.
So how do we distinguish between that kind of sign and a flag?
We would have to define it. We would have to show it. And we talked about having pictures in our definitions and sketches in our definitions to show exactly what that means and how to define
it. Is that so a draft?
This is a draft. Yeah, nice. This is a draft. This is a draft.
Oh, I guess we do say that a flag that has been adopted by the federal government, the state, or the local government, maybe. So I actually don't like that definition, because what if someone wants to hang a Greek flag?
Someone wants to hang a what?
A Greek flag.
Greek Independence Day is coming up.
And you guys just had your Easter.
Well, maybe it's
Independence Day.
Maybe it's any.
Actually, it already
any
happened.
Government.
March. Yeah, it should be.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Greek Independence Day is March.
By any UN recognized.
Yeah, something like that.
It's got a lot of holidays. It's great.
Then you have all the Palestinians. What are they going to do?
Let's not go there.
Actually, this was another question for the board. Was this? This is an example of adding graphics to the signage. Some of these show sign types, and some of these show how to calculate sign areas. As opposed to, this is Dennis Mass, which used pictures.
Right.
Which I didn't like at all. First of all, there's a lot of branding in here that. It's difficult and it's kind of messy. I think black and white graphics, simple, is best. So we're adding that in. These are just cut and pasted, some from international code and some from just web descriptions, but we'll probably draw up our own.
Okay.
Yeah, I like that much better than using examples. The idea of using, I don't know if this is what you have there, but using a picture of a McDonald's sign and saying "don't include," you can't do this.
Yeah.
To me, says that's bad. That's not the right.
No.
Yep. Message to send.
feeling comfortable and confident that this is something we could have in shape for the November timeline?
Well, that's my subcommittee.
Working group.
Working group.
How earlier than the November timeline? Like, you need it by September to be able to?
No, no.
Oh, no. July.
So I redid our little schedule. Let me just pull it up real quick so Tony can see it.
Yeah.
Oh.
Where did I put it?
June 20th meeting, it's two meetings from now.
So this is the schedule.
Well, if Nick and company can produce something, I mean, it's the signage in some area is an area where I think we should try hard to have something for the November meeting, because it has been both a town issue and the court issue. Mm-hmm. So we should have something, even if it's a very simple.
The flip side of that is, if we're not ready, we're not doing enforcement of signage. So town council has said, as long as we don't enforce, we don't run afoul.
Yeah, but that isn't that a problem, is that if we're not enforcing,
and
who knows,
more lollipops.
The longer that we go without enforcing,
right,
the more likelihood that we'll get something up there that we have to live with for a very long time that no one wants, except that particular business owner, right? I mean, that's...
It opens the door to a lot of things. But if we're not ready, we're not going to be in dire straits. I mean, if something's non-conforming, we have 6 years to bring it into conformance.
Explain
signage.
Explain that.
That's in the state statute. If we need to go back and do a year later and do enforcement, we're well within our rights.
How come we couldn't, even when we had this grant? Maybe that was before your time.
No, the grandfathering was here. Town council said the grandfathering wasn't
done in an appropriate manner.
No, the sunsetting provision, that was not legal, even though it was approved by the Attorney General.
If you remember, the zoning was written so that as of this date, you have, I think it was 10 years?
10 years.
10 years to...
Right, to... Yes.
Yep.
That sunsetting is illegal. However, if we write zoning today, we can look at, or if we write zoning in a year from now, whatever, we can look back 6 years, you said?
Yep.
To bring it into compliance. Although we had zoning before that, so.
Yeah.
If we write zoning now, what can we look back at for 6 years? If someone goes builds a sign tomorrow.
No, I was thinking, if somebody were to put something up and we didn't enforce that it was wrong, we would still have time to make that correction.
Wrong according to who, what rules?
The bylaw right now?
Right, like, in other words...
Yeah, but the bylaw right now...
The bylaw right now, the attorney is telling us not to enforce it.
Right.
But that doesn't mean that it's all wrong, either.
But if someone goes... How can that be?
Because not all of it is content-based, you know?
Right.
I mean, it's not
So if someone builds something, and part of the
freestanding sign has dimensional limitations to it. That is all enforceable. He can put whatever he wants on that sign. He could put a big FU right on it. You know, you can't tell him what to put on it, but he's got dimensional criteria. He's got setbacks, and that's a question we still have for the attorney, because if we can't regulate content, what can you put on that sign? So I don't believe that that's what the decision says, because You could get some pretty explicit language on a sign, and that means you can't enforce that? I don't believe that. I don't believe that was the intent. So there must be some sort of content-based decision-making that you can make.
And by the same token, the temporary signs, if somebody's doing something that's not allowed, and we say you can't do that, why is that so wrong? I don't understand why that's such a big problem to be enforcing that part of the bylaw.
I agree. I don't
parts where we could get in trouble is if we are enforcing parts of the bylaw that are content-based. But if somebody decides to put a big, giant, temporary sign in the middle of Main Street and we say, you can't do that, it has nothing to do with content.
Maybe seems to make sense to me.
It's as a practical matter. Maybe we can get town council to meet us halfway.
John, I think.
And maybe because you've gone through to, at this point, to identify what sections are content-based and which sections aren't content-based, then you can make that say, we can enforce this, and this because the existing one is not content-based at all.
Yeah, maybe. Should we see if he can come next to the next meeting?
Well, he should definitely come to the 20th if we're on target. Mm. If we're going to make the 20th meeting, he should be there, right?
I know. I was just thinking the sooner the better because the schedule is tight.
Well, he'll see it before then.
Mm.
We can't just show it to
him. Right,
he
will see it before
so
then. But do we want to get feedback?
Get the feedback?
As a group? Like a group working session, like you suggested?
Sometimes just getting, you know, a few folks in the room and sitting down with town council to give us a little more guidance isn't a bad use of our time. And to really get more clarification on this enforcement issue.
So when we do, somewhere between now and the 20th, right?
We have a meeting on May 23rd.
Okay, that's a month. That gives us a month to fix for the 20th.
Mm.
Oh, yes.
Going forward, sorry.
It's okay. I'm also wondering if we shouldn't try to get more hands on deck with this one since this is like the big.
Certainly, we post this and get. We'll take comments from anybody.
I'm happy. I'll definitely read this and provide comments
absolutely.
This week. I'm not going to be there the 23rd.
Okay.
But I'll definitely submit my feedback.
So we'll put it on the agenda for the 23rd and see if we can get town council to join us.
Sure.
Yep. Do we think that there's a broader public outreach element needed here?
Not yet.
I mean, I realize we're under the gun here if we want to get this in for November, but are we going to shoot ourselves in the foot for November if we don't get more public input?
This is so technical right now. We haven't changed. We haven't changed what's permitted yet. I don't want to say it that way. We haven't made significant changes to where anybody's going to be impacted just yet.
We have worked specifically on cleaning up as opposed to making any significant changes to regulation. So the goal would be that first pass is a clean version. And then you can make any changes you want. Automobile, sign height, whatever.
Yeah.
And that's probably the piece where it could be better discussed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you could see, you know how people are with track changes. This thing is full of comments with track changes right now. I'm still missing all these parameters.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So we would have all of that. I guess the 20th would be. If we're on track for the 20th, we'll know that. After the 23rd, then we could advertise that. And it looks like you've got a public hearing for the week of August 1st. That's for this.
Sorry, where are you seeing that?
I'm looking at the
August
schedule you have there. Update to drafts, public hearing. I'm sorry, it says second.
As needed after the second one.
Yep.
Um,
June 20th.
So if where we're supposed to be, if we are where we're supposed to be on the 20th, that draft gets put out there for public consumption.
Right.
Right.
We'd solicit comments up until the public hearing, essentially.
Yeah, that's a good 3 weeks till the first one. 5 weeks till the second
one. We'll have to do some heavy public outreach, though, to make sure people know it's out there. When did you talk about having this business community?
Right.
June 22nd.
Oh, so then they would know that it's out there.
So that's
okay.
Good. That's
here,
good.
So.
It fits.
Yeah. Just have some bad memory of a certain meeting where we just talked about this preamble and changes that were proposed to the preamble, and we got our heads ripped off for making those changes or those suggestions.
Yep.
I mean, there's a lot of history. I'm certainly not involved with a lot of the history, or I wasn't involved, but I know that there's some passionate people about this, so I just want to make sure we're careful with how we approach that. I don't want to get into a public forum when people throwing rotten fruit at us.
Well, maybe that's another thing to bring up with the Board of Selectmen and discuss it, you know, whatever night we go before them. Make sure we say, you know, we've been posting these meetings, which we have, and having a lot of conversation about sign by law at CPDC and at working group sessions that are publicly posted.
Yep.
And you made an announcement to town meeting, 192 town meeting members heard your discussion,
yeah.
Update. I think we sent something around to town meeting members, letting them know we were getting going again on zoning.
There's no Economic Development Committee anymore, right? It
no.
was disbanded?
Yes.
Okay, because that was the group that was pretty passionate about this. But we have a new, well, no, we don't. We've got an open position for an Economic Development
Coordinator,
yep.
But that has not been filled yet, right?
No, we just wrote the job description.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to have a little more internal discussion,
yeah.
And then
yeah.
We'll probably post it after that. I have it written. It's just...
Yeah, no, I wasn't
yeah.
sure if this
yeah.
could align with that at all, but it doesn't sound like it.
No one will take the job.
I know.
It's a tough job.
But you're right. You know, having a really good public outreach effort is important. There's town meeting members, there's the general public, there's the business community. And
the right level, or the right presentation at town meeting. Because I know we wouldn't do this, but going in and saying we got to make these changes because of a change to, or you know, the Supreme Court said this, that, and the other. We've not too long ago, a similar change was made around settling some litigation, and they felt like they were, you know, in hindsight, or after the fact, they were kind of painted into a corner.
Mm.
So I want to make sure we're clear of what's changed, and just make it clear that we haven't changed a lot of the regulations, per se.
Well, hopefully this time, when we go before town meeting like we did last year, there won't be so much information to have to digest. I think
sure.
that was what made it tough when we did the big swooping changes.
Mm-hmm.
It was just so much information.
But this is, I don't know. I've been talking about this for a few weeks now, and I'm still having a hard time understanding what the heck's going on.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we've just got to be clear.
And maybe at a certain point, we just do the best we can and then have town council take it from there. We've done that in the past, too. Well, we gotten it to a certain point, and then town council finishes it. It's a draft that they
mm-hmm.
then go through and...
Wrong. That's it?
I mean, that's kind of what happened on the purpose, is a lot of those changes were made by town council. And, you know, some of them went too far, I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
we looked at 8 or 9 different preambles from different communities, and we picked the language we felt was the most complementary to Reading.
Yeah, no, I think it's
so
great. I think it's a great improvement. So what did we say are kind of the milestones? 5/23 is our next meeting.
Put it on the agenda for CPDC for 5/23, and we'll invite town council.
Okay.
We'll...
Should the working group try to meet one more time before then so that we can really figure out what it is we need answered?
Yeah, but probably in a couple, we probably want to do a couple weeks worth of work on this, don't you think?
Probably.
The 23rd is a couple weeks away.
Mm. Yeah, we have to sometime next week.
Like soon, you mean? Yeah.
Okay.
And then we're saying we would get it in front of the Board of Selectmen, not in front of, but we'd provide an update to the Board of Selectmen in that same meeting?
I don't know. Oh, the meeting where we meet with them about this 40R.
Yeah.
Is that a lot? Is that too much?
I think it probably be a good opportunity to focus on the things we're targeting for fall town meeting. And it sounds like at this point, signs and, you know, we know we're not going to have downtown zoning figured out, but I think just almost as a check-in with the Board of Selectmen to make sure, you know, the path that's being followed is kind of what they're thinking too.
But we were going to talk to them about downtown zoning as well.
Yeah, I think
it's kind of two parts.
But I think to just broadly, I don't think we need to get into a lot of minutia, but really more to get their feedback and check in with where we are right now on all of this. We're at this point with the sign bylaw, we're at this point with downtown zoning, you know,
mm-hmm.
We're kind of headed in a direction for town meeting where we think we might have this and this, and we've got some public outreach scheduled, you know, and just more or less give them an update, a more detailed update to them than we did to town meeting.
Okay.
It's another opportunity for the public to see it on TV.
Exactly.
And to hear about
yep.
it as well.
Yep.
So.
Tony?
If you're planning on presenting this to the business community on the 22nd of June, and you're going to have a meeting to review it on the 20th of June at CPDC, then that next Tuesday, the 21st, you might want to put it in front of the Board of Selectmen so they're not blindsided when you're presenting it to the business community.
Yeah, I think as early as we can get on in June is probably, if it's ready.
Be a four-night
four
meeting
for four.
Week for us.
4/4.
All right.
I don't know. I feel like that meeting with the Board of Selectmen, I want to focus primarily on the rezoning priorities.
The downtown?
Yeah. And, I mean, provide another update on similar, I mean, maybe a little bit more detail than what was provided at town meeting, but talk a little bit about what we're targeting for November. And that would just be a quick update.
I think that one of the changes that we are clearly targeting for November would be something on the signage.
Right. Oh, yeah.
So... this, I mean, what you're saying is that we should go ahead and put something before the Board of Selectmen at that meeting.
Yeah. Just want to think about how much.
Well, the thing is that we need to synchronize the intent, I guess, which is not necessarily the detail, the individual items, but there's... clearly we're going to fix it up so that it is less vulnerable to challenge on the basis of the High Court decision. But also remind them, and I think this is something that you were having questions about, John, was the fact that we are not enforcing things immediately doesn't mean that we can't enforce them ex post facto. You know, the looking back 6 years says that whether or not you choose to enforce it now, if it in fact violates one of the provisions, you can go back and challenge them after we get things straightened out.
All I'm saying is, I'm sure that if someone wants to, they can probably put up some signs that we can't go back and, there's enough holes, I think, and maybe I'm wrong, but I think there's enough holes in the existing bylaw that are content-based that are not enforceable, that there is a likelihood that people can put up some signs that we don't want.
Yeah, but if
right
we
now.
Come up...
And we wouldn't be able to go back and enforce those
but
because
if,
of content-based.
If we come up with a new set of regulations which is less content-based.
Yeah.
And it also violates that, or in other words,
well, it wouldn't violate that, then wouldn't.
Well, maybe it is. Maybe
oh
maybe
no,
you
but
say it could.
What?
It could.
Yeah.
If it.
Yeah,
if
but that doesn't even matter because those zoning. If someone puts up a sign now, it has nothing to do with what we.
I'm talking about.
To talk about in the future.
Right.
That's something different.
Now they have to meet the code that we have.
Right.
That's enforceable.
Right.
Or not enforceable.
Or not enforceable.
But on the books.
Yep.
Could it be done
okay.
in two bites, maybe? Just bring a cleanup so that we're...
Not exposed.
Yeah. Do a cleanup version in November.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that's what we're doing.
Yeah.
Isn't that what we're doing?
Well, we still want to make some changes, we think.
Okay.
I think that's where we are so far, is just with the cleanup.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we don't take on the rest of it, but we just get it cleaned up so that by November, town meeting just has a cleaned up version, no substantive changes.
Well, remember, the cleanup includes this, the definitions.
Yep.
And this enumeration of temporary signs, really. So the table, the dimensional table, the table at the back end changes too.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the sign types will go away, and then some will just be listed as temporary, and then
right.
we got to make sure each of the zoning districts has something.
But the point about trying to maybe revisit sizes of signs in business A and numbers
mm-hmm.
of signs, maybe that waits.
That might.
Yeah, it might not be a bad idea to see how the cleaned up bylaw works for a year. You know,
yeah.
Before we start changing it as well.
At least at that point, to try and explain it to town meeting, we could present them with something that just basically keeps us out of hot water.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not anything we've decided, it's something that's imposed upon us by others.
Okay.
Yeah, it sounds like we're not that far off from.
Well,
I mean, that's the direction
that's where
we're
we
going
are anyway.
In, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
with a few exceptions,
right.
But.
And maybe it's a longer conversation about, you know, with more stakeholders about what do you think if we change it this way, and what do you think if we change it that way, and this many signs versus that many, and.
Okay. Tony.
Town meeting for the override, an October election or vote, and then the November elections, and then November town meeting. Because you're looking at 6 weeks between the end of having the warrant ready and the actual town meeting.
The warrant closes on September 27th.
Okay.
So that's why everything really has to be done and voted on by August. I know. That's what makes it really hard. Because we've done it the other way around and said, oh no, we can, you know, get it on the warrant and then keep working on the draft language, and it doesn't work. We found out.
All right.
It works, but it doesn't work well.
So we good on signage?
I think so.
Moving right along.
Honestly, I think I'm still a little unclear of what's happening between now and the end of June, but maybe I'll call you tomorrow and we can...
Sure.
You can help me. Maybe just tired.
I'm not... I can tell you what I've heard tonight and hope that I'm
Yeah, maybe we'll just compare notes.
Okay.
Cool.
Next up is the site plan review.
Oh, yeah.
I actually took a big whack at it this time.
I've actually got minor amendments next, but let's do site plan review. Just looking at the agenda.
Oh, you're right.
That's all right. Let's do site plan review.
So John and I met and we talked about recent history of changes to site plan review and some of the logic behind why we have site plan, minor site plan, and then minor site plan by administrative approval. And it's tricky to know exactly how to set thresholds in a way that's A, something that we isn't just completely based on a judgment call, but B, will capture those things that could slip through the cracks. So I took a stab at it. But it's totally up for discussion. So
a couple of things. One, you know, the last time we revised this, and I'm jumping to this interior alteration of 2,000 square feet, 2,000 square feet of floor area or more. If I remember correctly, there was something even smaller than that at one point, like interior of 500 mm-hmm. square feet. And so in our latest iteration, we said, well, we really only want to look at things that are really big.
Mm-hmm.
And then Julie was like, well, why do you even want to do that? And so the things that, like the one that came in front of us based on this 2,000 square foot was when they redid the task building or whatever we call it now. One of the floors, they redid the lighting, right? Or they redid, you know, even
since
the
I was
building
here?
I'm talking about.
The old Keurig building.
Keurig building.
Yeah. 55 Walker's Brook
yes.
Drive.
Yes. But even, I know when we saw that, we were like.
I don't think size is the.
The size isn't the right thing.
No.
It's not the right metric.
So we took one step from 500 to 2,000, but in reality, I'm not when you think about it, at least for interior, what we really care is what's the use or what's the externality from that change.
Exactly.
And so the idea, let's just get rid of the interior alteration because
mm-hmm.
that really doesn't make sense for anything that we look at.
Do we have to say interior alteration with no change of use?
So we got in here instead the change of use in item C is if we're going to change a use from one category to another.
You're talking about, yeah, under applicability,
right.
462.
I'm sorry, yeah.
On the first page.
So A is not exterior alteration, it's any increase in gross floor area.
Right.
Yeah, this is, and this would be for,
which by definition is typically an expansion or an addition.
Right.
That would be for a site plan review.
That's for site
like
plan
a full,
review.
Yeah, so that has a direct impact probably to the exterior of
yep.
the building and how the site layout functions.
So that's getting rid of that horizontal or vertical 500 square foot, but
down.
Putting that into minor
yeah.
site plan.
You're increasing
review.
The size of
that
the building.
That was
right.
it actually worked. I think we helped out the process, but that was like repainting. There's one building where they resided up on South Main Street. There's what's it, Chick's.
Little Chucks.
Yeah,
Little Chucks.
Yeah, where they resided that with
yep.
the stone. I think that we ended up helping that
yes.
process. But there's another example where
all they were doing was residing.
Yep.
And we, it's not really a full site plan
yep.
review type of thing. So when you think about it, it really is, it's when you're expanding,
yep.
when you're changing the footprint.
Yep.
Or if you're adding a second floor within a building that has a lot of height.
Right.
A single floor.
Yeah.
But you're adding parking requirements potentially, intensity.
Yeah, and that's the other, the second piece is
and
parking.
Actually, maybe it's not an increase in gross floor area, but a modification?
No, it's...
No, I like increase.
Well,
here,
if you have a building and they're taking one addition that's on one side of the building and 500 square foot and rebuilding, you know, putting adding a different addition on another side of the building, in total they're not changing the, they're not increasing the gross floor area, but they're changing the building.
An increase in net gross floor area?
Net is not a term that the building inspector likes at all.
So we'll define it. He'll have to
no.
use it.
It's already defined.
Net. But it's not meant as the net. Okay, then how would you define it? If you take 500 square feet off of this end of the building and you put it on this end of the building, you have no net increase.
Oh, I thought you were saying net floor area.
No, I was trying to say, you can come up with a better word, but you know what I'm saying.
You're saying a net increase in gross floor.
Shuffling the deck and you still have the same number of occupants.
But if we say net increase, then that doesn't capture what John's getting
yeah,
at.
Yeah, I mean, that may be a big impact. You're changing the whole site plan.
There's a site plan impact.
Right. So you should. I mean, that's where I'm saying is maybe it's not increase, it's modification of.
But then we have to exclude people that modify 500 square feet of interior space that really, they don't add anything.
Yeah.
All right, so
right?
That needs
you know?
To be thought out a little, that's all.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
What'd you say, Nick?
We need to think this one through a little bit so
yeah.
that we can capture that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, and, you know, maybe it's just my opinion, but the 4621, which is basically excluding, would be a lot clearer if it were two separate paragraphs or statements. Basically, 4621 would be single-family, two-family structures are exempt from site plan review, period. And then as an additional thing, routine maintenance and in-kind replacement is exempt from site plan review. Just put it into two statements and it's
yeah.
much more clear.
That's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that.
Okay.
And so do we need to have a third sentence that says what we mean by routine? Well, we know what routine maintenance is, but in-kind replacement
of lighting, mechanical systems, and landscape features. I mean,
that's a code term.
I mean, I think maybe we want to specify lighting, mechanical systems, and it's like what we were talking about earlier.
Yeah.
Because, like, if someone moves their air conditioning unit to the setback and it's really noisy. You know, then it's like, do I have to make the judgment call that we have to, that has to be approved, or do I have to?
Something now might be going on the roof, or you're changing over to LED and it's really super bright.
Yeah, I think we do have to define.
But you're saying in-kind replacement.
I know, but like Jean pointed out, technologies are always changing. So like if your HVAC system breaks, you're probably not going to replace it with like, you might replace it with a better technology that has some sort of other impact in some way. I don't know. Or like if you replace your lighting, you might replace your, you know, halide light with a LED light that's much, much brighter and
less orange.
Less orange, right, and doesn't emit heat.
Yeah,
but
you're
I don't know.
Some of that stuff I guess you can't capture.
Right.
You're just going to have to be reasonable. You know, it's dealing with people that are reasonable. Because you cannot, right? You can't catch everything. If you can catch everything, that it's going to be, talk about non-business friendly, right? I mean, it's going to be massive, our zoning.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't think that that's the.
Maybe we say something like, as long as none of these in-kind replacements are occurring in principal yard setback areas.
Well.
Allowed to do that anyways? Are you allowed to do that? Can you take a, say, a rooftop unit, put it down on the side yard?
I mean, you could, you can have like an air conditioning unit in a side yard setback.
You could?
Mm-hmm.
Why do we allow that? In a commercial district, not in a residential district?
Mm-hmm.
But the.
It depends.
Isn't, can you capture it by including a phrase saying, maintenance and replacement, blah, 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 in conformity with the prior site condition or site plan? Basically says, if it's conforms to the same conditions for the original site plan.
Yeah, but there's a lot of times no original site plan.
Yeah.
Well, then it's site condition, I mean, it's.
Some of the older ones are thin on detail.
Maybe we'll think about this.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it the way, you know, breaking it up into two statements. It just is a little bit vague sometimes when you have to make a judgment call.
Sometimes that's good.
Yeah. Mm. Except when you judge wrong.
Well, that's
thank you,
James. You never make mistakes. You grow.
Whoops.
And then I reduced the part, the change in pavement, the parking requirement. It was 15 spaces triggering it, but I thought that was a lot.
That
seems kind of high.
For Reading.
So I lowered it just to, I mean, because don't we want to know if someone's restriping a commercial parking lot and maybe it's changing the whole layout of, and it's a blocking a drive aisle, or they don't have to come in for a permit for restriping, but if they are paving, they do. I don't know.
Well, they're not going to get a permit for paving.
They don't have to get a permit for paving?
No.
No, that's why the people paving over their aquifer protection
yes.
district pervious areas.
Yeah.
So then
no.
we need to tie B and C together, right? A change
yeah.
of use. Then that's the way they were.
Yeah, that's. I think that's why it was that way.
Okay, so it needs to be, I think C should actually stay the little, I don't know.
New construction.
Maybe a change, B can be a change of use that results in or requires.
Well, it's a change of use as written in a multifamily structure or that causes the, you know, the change in parking.
Mm.
Okay. Okay. All right.
Any problem with decreasing the parking threshold?
I thought 15 was high too.
Yeah.
Two seems like maybe go a little
it's
higher
too
than
too
two,
low.
But maybe go to five.
Maybe five.
But I don't know.
It all depends where you are in Reading, right? I mean, five in downtown is a huge change.
Yeah.
Five out at Walkers Brook is like
no
you would you wouldn't even notice it. So, but the reality is that if someone's redoing something in any of those big parking lots, chances are they're not, it's not just that. They're
yeah.
probably going to do, it's probably something bigger that's going to change across the threshold anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's not going to be the thing. It's likely the thing that's downtown where they may be trying to do a little here and a little there.
Right. And two could be a lot.
That's what we had talked through.
Keep it two, and if we end up with 40 applications.
Yeah, we're like, oh, whoop, that was wrong.
We'll change it.
Well,
it's a work in progress.
The right. alternative would be instead of using two or more spaces, just say square footage. Because a parking space is like 170 square feet, right?
10 by 20.
Yeah, I mean, so, so if you said, I mean, basically the, if it's a change in location or restriping involving more than 500 square feet of paved area, that's like 2.5 spaces.
You wanna do that?
Well, that's sort of what, we have this increase in pavement of more than 300 square feet.
Well, it's increase in pavement, but this would be better. If somebody had a big driveway and they restripped the thing to make it, more parking places, you know, maybe that's, would be enough of a change in circulation and so forth that you wanna pay attention to it.
Well, the only thing is, as I read this the second time, like, we're never gonna know if someone stripes existing pavement necessarily.
Right. Yep.
So, I think it really does have to come down to an increase in pavement or a use that triggers the need for additional parking.
It's the change to the layout or location is the, which result in pavement, curb cut changes, that
right.
sort of thing.
Right.
Paving and restriping, I mean, just restriping alone is not gonna, that's not, that's
right.
never gonna be something we're even aware of.
Well, unless they voluntarily come forward, yeah.
yeah.
Because we told them that they should.
Let's, I kind of, I mean, I
so
think it's easy
the
to
rest
read.
Of this is fairly self-explanatory.
Yeah, yeah.
If you have any comments, you know.
Oh, this is good. This
shoot
is
us an email.
Good stuff. I mean, what, do
sense.
We have any next steps we want on this? Review it, send
your
feedback?
Input, yeah, your input, send
okay.
feedback.
Yeah. And I'll
I mean,
have
the
to
rest of it, it's really those thresholds.
Really?
The rest
yeah.
of it
yeah.
Is and
just me trying to conserve. Paper.
Yeah, and Julie polled on, and we've talked about this, is having copies of
yep.
what we really need.
Yeah,
right.
So she's getting that down and down and down, which is good. So.
All right. But other than our input, this is probably at a point where we're in good shape for
yep.
public
yeah.
hearings and
yeah.
stuff.
Yep.
Okay. All right, good. Let's keep moving. It's
yep.
9:40. Let's try to wrap up within the next 20 minutes if we can. Minor amendments. So do you want to provide the update? Do you want me to?
You can if you want.
So I refer, there's a couple of categories of minor updates. Accessory buildings and structures. This was a pretty confusing section. That was the feedback that that you were receiving, right? In general, a lot of words. So I took a stab at trying to reorganize it, try to slim back some language. Julie took that and slimmed it down and reorganized it even more.
I had the building inspector review it, and he added a, he gave me a couple of good tidbits to include.
I think that this is a good draft, and at this point would request your feedback on on what you see and if you think anything needs mm-hmm. to change or so on and so forth. The accessory apartment one.
The only thing we really changed about that was just to remove net floor area and just use gross and gross because it was trying to remember exactly what it was.
Yeah, I am too.
Yeah,
someone
the gross needs to match back to someplace else where we talk
it's
about
in
it.
It was the first
the
sentence
first sentence.
Says gross and
yep.
then the last one said net, which was enabling people to have really large spaces that they called closets that don't technically count towards net gross
yep.
net floor area, and Glenn was having a nightmare with that, so
yep. He's okay with this.
Net excludes like a lot of things
mm-hmm.
that, so the actual
mm-hmm.
gross area of the structure they were proposing was much bigger
yep.
than yeah
okay.
You kind of get out of it that way
yeah
so yeah he wanted the net just completely removed.
Good. The next one, was just, this one was just a numbering change, right?
Yeah.
So.
And then lot shape was a discussion, because, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Okay. So, I asked, my confusion about lot shape was when it applies, whether Glenn applies it to existing lots that already have a structure on them or, and that are already created, or whether he applies it when someone comes in with a subdivision plan. And he said he doesn't apply it to existing lots at all. So he's never asking someone who owns a piece of existing property with boundaries that exist to figure out that calculation. That's what he told me. So then I'm wondering, well, where is the confusion coming from? Because an engineer is the most equipped person to design, to understand this calculation. So I wasn't sure if anyone remembered.
The pushback we've gotten from the public on this is that if you have an irregular lot, the making a change that would require the lot shape calculation means that they have to go out and hire a surveyor to get the measure, the perimeter.
Like if someone wanted to take a piece of their neighbor's property?
Or...
then they would have to make sure it...
If it's going to trigger Glenn's question about lot shape, and I'm not sure offhand what those might be, changes, subdivision, new driveway, or whatever.
In which case... You have to anyways.
You have to hire the surveyor.
You have to hire the surveyor.
If he's never asking an existing lot to do calculation, that means if you're putting an addition on, you're not doing that calculation.
Yeah, and I've never seen him ask anyone or overheard him.
I mean, I know someone brought that up at the meeting that we had.
Someone did bring it up,
someone
but I
did.
Couldn't remember.
It was, what's her name? She ran for Board of Selectmen.
Oh.
Karen.
Yeah,
Herrick.
Yeah,
yes.
So she said she had some difficulty with something, so, but it was unclear exactly what the issue was there. Because the calculation seemed straightforward,
yeah.
And certainly an engineer or a surveyor could do it,
I
and
think
you're having the plan made.
The problem for me, really, is how it's worded, how it says, in all residence districts, no building or structure may be constructed on a lot unless the lot satisfies. Because it makes it seem like any time someone wants to add a structure to their lot, or if they have an existing vacant lot, then they have to...
Which may be what the confusion and the concern is, right? Because if you say, especially if we start to design, say that structures are, accessory buildings, right? You're gonna go to Home Depot and buy a shed and get a permit.
You have to figure out, reading through this,
and you're like, in order to do that, I have to calculate this.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That may be what.
Well, what if it says constructed on a newly created lot?
Yeah.
Or no newly created lot shall. Or all newly created lots shall satisfy the following requirements. I don't know.
We want it to be a positive, right?
Maybe we need to ask like an engineer, some
well,
engineer.
Well, it's basically a definition of a buildable lot.
Right.
Right.
It shouldn't be tied to the structure.
In all residence districts, right? You get rid of the no building or structure may be constructed on.
A buildable lot must meet the following requirements.
For a newly created building. Because he's not going to, if you have 5,000 square feet and 50 feet of frontage, he's not going to tell you you can't, even if it's a triangle or something, he's not going to tell you you can't.
Well, he's going to tell you that if there's already a house you can build, but
right,
if there isn't,
that's
you
the
can't.
Difference, is if it's not a buildable lot and there's no house on it, he's gonna tell you, because it may or may not say on the A&R plan,
right,
whether it's a buildable lot or not. We, in we've been encouraging that, that to be put on there, but that doesn't have to be put on there.
No.
So there may be some lots that are considered, that we would all consider non-buildable, non-buildable lots, and that this is perfect for that. If there's already a house on there, what Glenn is saying, he doesn't apply that, or a structure.
Okay, so then I'll just have to say
he's
then, is a buildable lot shall.
That can't be
true. The whole buildability, no, the buildability thing's based on other factors like wetlands and frontage and stuff like that.
But here we're talking about lot shape, and so all we have to say is a buildable lot shall comply with the following or something.
Yep.
Right?
I
we don't have
so.
To say whether it's about putting a structure on it or not.
Yeah.
It doesn't say whether it's new or
right.
old. It doesn't
yes.
say whether there's
right.
a structure on it. Just this is the lot shape.
What was that again?
Buildable
a
lot.
A buildable lot must conform to the following.
Yeah.
The following requirements, right? Or buildable lot satisfies the
shall
following
satisfy
requirements.
The following requirements.
Cool.
Okay.
Good. The next one was animal kennel versus pet grooming. We agreed that we needed to have a distinction between, we need to have two definitions. Right now we only have animal kennel.
Yep.
So we've got a draft definition for pet grooming, and then we've got it added into our table of uses.
I added it into principal uses, and then on the back, oh no, I didn't put it in accessory.
So it's the animal kennel at the bottom of accessory uses?
I didn't add it there for some reason. I had a reason. Oh, because I was thinking if someone wanted to do it out of their home, that would be a home occupation or a
right.
special home occupation. It would be captured that way.
Yeah, because it's pet grooming is included or could be included special home occupation.
Okay.
And then special home occupation, can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's kind of like a like right now we have a definition of home occupation that it's a business use conducted in a residential use that's clearly secondary to the residential use and only run by someone who lives, any residents that live there. So like if Nick, you started working from home and you wanted to have someone come help you every once in a while, you wouldn't be able to. So special home occupation kind of allows for a little bit more to happen in your home, but it requires a special permit. So I was thinking it could capture something like, where did I write that?
Well, it's basically, it's a home occupation with an employee.
Or where you might have like someone teaching music lessons and they have a parent dropping a kid off. Like it's creating a little bit more, it's not like an obvious use from the outside, but it's enabling more economic opportunity in the house.
You're adding traffic to a residential
right,
neighborhood.
But it,
so
right, so it's something that needs to go through a process.
We had somebody call about this, right? A developer
who's
gonna have other.
There's been a couple people, a guy who wanted to have a contractor's yard in his front yard, and then a guy who wanted to run a tech business out of his house, and he was like, how come your bylaw has no regulations for this? He's like, all I want to have is one guy come over. Is that allowed or isn't it? And I had to tell him it's not, because technically right now it can only be him.
Yeah.
But the reality is he could have a friend come over every single day and no one would know.
Nope.
So, I mean, there's that.
Right, but you give them one car, do they have three?
Right, exactly.
Well, this is my friend, but that's the employee, now that's two. So you really have to be careful with that.
Mm.
Which is why I thought having it be a use.
Mm-hmm.
Because when he comes in, if he wants to register the business, that's when we figure out what's going on.
Yeah, it's going to spur a lot of discussion.
You think?
Yeah,
I'm
not saying it's bad, I'm just making it.
I think I remember a recent rejection of somebody's, essentially this, special home occupation.
Yeah.
on.
And it still has limits too.
Walnut.
It's not allowing, you know, carte blanche, do whatever you want.
Let's think about that. If that's gonna sink all the other changes, maybe we don't wanna take it on right now. Or if we think it's worthwhile, we can proceed. Have it as a separate warrant.
It's not a difficult thing to strike, right?
That's true. Yeah, I just think back to purpose where we could have struck probably one bullet and kept moving a few years back, but we didn't.
Which part do you think is gonna, were you saying one part of it should be taken out or the
No,
whole
no,
thing?
No, I'm just saying if all of these are under one article and all of them are pretty much, you know, not too controversial or confusing, but this special home occupation, to John's point, I hadn't really thought about it, but you're right. It could cause a lot of conversation.
Because it's
won't that come up at our public hearing, though? Well, we'll talk about it at the public hearing. We'll say, look, this is the possible downside to this.
Oh, the other thing that I added was parking garaging of more than one commercial vehicle, because this happens, like, all the time. So this is... They need to get a permit from the Board of Appeals if they want to have, like, multiple commercial vehicles parked in their driveway.
Okay.
Otherwise, we don't really have a limit, so it's kind of, as long as it's on pavement and it's registered, which is, I get a lot of calls about, you know, why that's allowed next door to me.
So again, I guess for all of these, let's take some time over the next couple of weeks, review the changes, send any feedback to Julie, and we'll be good. Tony.
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. Mr. Chairman, did you look at section 7.5, the single lot exemption?
Oh, yeah, that's the phone. That's the phone.
Last half of the final sentence where it says whether or not such lot was zoned for residential or non-residential use at the time of the increase. I believe this was what the section that was brought up at the last, not the last, but the second to last town meeting, where the house was built on that sliver of land on South Main Street.
Mm-hmm. This is the thing we were talking about with the grandfather. Does it apply to that?
Yeah, I think we said there were four.
Somebody, Mary Ellen, who brought up the fact that there's a whole section, whole neighborhood, is it near the water tower that's potentially buildable now because of this?
When we had our GIS person do a map, I think there were four or five lots that would qualify.
There were more that qualified, but there were four that had been businesses. Remember, it was this business thing that...
The way this is written...
Or the non-residential thing.
Right.
But there were a bunch that were residential that qualified for this, that were residential, stayed residential, and qualified for this. I thought the list was longer.
Well, the state law allows that anyway. Ours just goes further by including the business reference.
Right.
So, regardless, it's protected under state law.
The residential ones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what this does is it makes it's either four or five more buildable lots.
Right. Yeah.
It takes the state statute and makes it a little more expansive.
And there was a reason that we didn't talk. Well,
I don't understand. So this says that there was complaints in town meeting about this as an unintended consequence for that particular lot on South Street.
But that's not what happened. We said in the track changes in the big document that we had all the changes highlighted, we said this was to settle a lawsuit, and it was in there, and we talked about it at, on the floor of town meeting, that there was a provision in here, because if town meeting wasn't going to approve this bylaw, we needed to pull that out to settle this lawsuit. So the town manager got up and spoke about that on the floor of town meeting. We reviewed the tape. It's there. So we, we're talking about, like I say, it's either four or five lots that, that because of this language are now protected. Otherwise, it would fall under state law, and it would be, the residential would be covered anyway.
When you say this language, the whether, you were just talking about whether or not such lot was zoned for residential or non-residential use at the time of the increase.
Right.
That's really all we're talking about, right?
Right.
I mean, that's the only difference between what we have
and
what
state
law approves.
Yeah. That was the only difference. And it wasn't an unintended consequence.
It was an intended consequence that I'll say that we weren't necessarily upfront about.
Well, we had it in
the
changes.
It
said
but it wasn't explained. That's the problem.
Well,
it was a court. It was a lawsuit that we were. You said it was said, not you.
Yeah.
It was said.
Yeah.
No one really understood what that meant. That's the issue. Because a lot of, like you said, there's a lot of stuff that was said in that meeting. There's a lot going on.
What happens if we strike that part now?
Well,
I don't think that.
I'm trying to understand. If it means that you can now build a single family house on a lot that was zoned for non-residential use, where are those lots?
We can show you the map tomorrow.
Yeah, we have a map.
And, you know, what zoning do we have which is non-residential in a residential zone? I mean,
It's hard to explain without having the map.
I'll find the map.
Want to spend some time on this in the next meeting, this one?
Yeah, probably makes, if, especially if town council's coming. Coming in the next one.
You bring that up, Tony, as a consideration for another minor amendment potentially, or
if you would like, I would certainly do so.
Why don't we have this discussion when town council's here on May 23rd?
Yeah.
Because I mean, I've, you know, if it's residential use in business A, you know, I mean, where the hell are these things?
We'll get the map and we'll have town council explain it.
Okay.
You know, if it's non-buildable for some other reason, then let it be non-buildable.
You guys
want to
do minutes?
Let's keep moving.
The library sign.
The library sign first.
Approved.
The pedestal's already built, so.
Yeah, they already built the pedestal.
So they were dealing with some site issues and had to get the footings in. And then the issue came up about this sign that we really never talked about, the library sign. We never had it in the decision. So I thought it was best that we at least give a heads up to the board that it's a little bit different than what was there before. I didn't realize they were doing much of a change, but it's a different sign. There's no illumination. I guess the lighting of the site is enough.
Right, a little bit taller, a little bit narrower.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that'd be right.
Because it used to be Reading Public Library.
Yeah.
It's Reading Public Library.
Yep.
I think.
So before, you know, they approached me about it, and I said, I really don't feel comfortable saying yes or no to this. I think the board should at least have a look at it.
I have a picture of it somewhere.
There it is.
I think maybe the next one's better. Nope.
No, I think that one's good.
Okay.
Why don't I think it was a light background with dark letters?
I think this thing is already being fabricated.
How does this fit with our sign regulations?
We don't regulate these.
The, you know, because it's municipal.
No, that wasn't the question.
Yeah.
With our sign regulations, how does this fit in, because we went through, I
yeah, we looked at it.
What zoning district is this?
It would be a resident, we have certain sign regulations for.
Residence goes to business B.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
And business B doesn't allow freestanding signs except, do we, you know, I guess we do allow them now. But the main thing, I think, is the side setbacks in business B.
Because.
Freestanding sign is 35 square feet max area, 14 foot height, 20 foot side setback.
Yep.
So, this is actually taller than the new definition for monumental sign. All right, so this is 3 feet or so to the bottom of the sign.
It's not a monument sign per se.
Freestanding is what I was going to call it.
I went with freestanding in business.
Freestanding in business B.
Yeah, so
has a 14 foot. Yeah.
Monument sign definition in the new section.
Right. Yeah.
And this is not in compliance with that now?
Depends on what grade it is. If they're saying grade is brick.
Yeah.
Then I guess it does.
Right.
Close to it.
But then it's, you said 3 feet, right? So it would be close.
35 square feet? No, it's not close.
No, I thought you said 3 feet on the bottom part.
In the new language.
Right.
I don't want to confuse the issue.
Yeah.
In the future, this may not be a monumental sign, maybe considered a freestanding sign.
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Because it's too tall.
Oh, because
the
it doesn't
base of it's too tall. Yeah, we talk about it in a monumental sign. I think we say that the base is no more than 2 feet high.
Right.
But in terms of the old, the existing unenforced sign bylaw.
Right, so if you only consider the sign area, this is 3.5 by 8.
Seven. Oh, just the sign area.
Just the sign area, just the dark brown area.
4. Oh, wait, no.
3.5 by, I'm just blocking it out.
Are you looking at 94? Inches.
Yeah, 42.5 by 90.
94.
I'm not including the little trim pieces.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get close. So what's that? Somebody did the math.
96 is 8 feet. So that's
3.5, 24, 28.
28.
So it's
28
it's
square feet.
Under the 35.
Yep.
27.
Yeah. So it complies. Does it comply with the setback? It must, right? Because it's the driveway's on that side.
Yeah, there's all kinds of this miles.
Yeah, so it's more than 20 feet over. And we say 0 on the front setback.
Is that the same spot that it was previously, roughly? I know that they had to put in the new.
No, I don't think so.
I don't
know where it was.
The
driveway changed.
Yeah.
The driveway used to be lawn, so.
Yeah.
12.5 inches from the, I think, the back of the sidewalk.
Mm-hmm.
So then that's a decent, 12.5 feet.
So it would have complied.
I'm good with it as long as it complies. I don't think that, if we're going to apply zoning to municipal projects, like I think we should, like we did for the rest of the site, mm-hmm. like we did have for everywhere else, as is our policy
mm-hmm.
per town manager, then we should do it consistently. So as long as that occurs, I don't think we should be giving anyone a pass because they forgot that they needed to come.
Agree.
Yeah, that's why I wanted to bring it back to you guys tonight.
My take.
Tony?
I Pedraza, 130 John Street, not wanting to be a wet blanket. Which line in the table of dimensional controls are you looking at for freestanding sign in business B?
Not the second to last one?
You're looking at service stations.
17. Why?
Oh,
we need to
that's
look at
service stations, yeah.
Well, it's the same.
The
not
height's
quite.
A little bit different.
It's
the
not
height's
10 feet. That wasn't 10 feet, was it?
Not 10, no.
Three and a half
was,
and two
I think it was
8 five,
feet.
About
it's
6 or 7 feet. There's a person standing next to it.
Yeah.
No, but there's requirement of J. Freestanding signs shall be printed only when the principal business entrance is located more than 40 feet from the center line of the street in front of the lot. The main entrance to the library is in the back.
CPDC may waive the 40-foot business entrance setback requirement for signs in existence.
There you go.
There you go.
Back and forth.
And they need a special permit.
In existence as of the effective date of this amendment, not blanket.
Yeah.
Yeah. C section for special permit criteria.
So what do we do?
So do we have to waive that through a special, through a something?
Administrative?
Wait, why isn't the principal entrance more than 40 feet from the center line of the street? It's the it's
in the front
it's
of
the
lot.
Entire width of the building plus the lot. Doesn't the where the principal entrance is located more than 40 feet from the central line of the street?
In front.
In front.
Oh. I'm
the
reading
street
the principal
in front
entrance
lot.
In front of the lot.
No. The street in front
the
of
street,
the lot.
Okay.
Okay.
So I've got the width of the yard plus
yeah.
the building and the main principal mm-hmm. entrance. So I'm well over 40 feet.
Why are we not looking at section 8268 through 829?
Is that the government section?
By the regulation, it does not need to
no.
comply because it's a government, it's our internal government section. But town manager's direction has been for transparency to hold everything to the standard of the zoning. Unless there's some reason not to, you know, something
that's right.
public interest. So we're showing that it does comply in case, we're just showing you that it does comply. It doesn't have to, but it does.
It's a really a as a courtesy to make sure we're not way off.
Sure.
That's what you said, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it complies.
Yeah, yeah.
It complies by quite a bit.
Okay.
It's not an obnoxious sign, it's very simple. Need
no
a sign.
Illumination? Is that what you said?
No illumination. Nope.
All right. You want to hit that right aid question first before we do?
Yeah, so, I was going to actually try to find the other thing.
You emailed me earlier today about some modifications that Rite Aid's looking to make. Not the Rite Aid on Haven, the other one?
The Bolton Street one.
The Bolton Street.
So they have.
Which?
They have some interior.
On the way to Market Basket, that one.
Okay.
Former Oscar drug.
You mean the one that was always a Rite Aid?
They have some interior work that they want to do, which is like pretty standard. They're just refinishing and renovating the interior. And then they have some exterior work they want to do, and that's the part I was focusing on. Because none of this interior stuff really seemed to be that big of a deal. So over the past few weeks, I've been emailing back and forth with them. I had a lot of questions before. I wanted to ask Jeff like if he thought it could be an administrative approval or should come to you, but I wanted to get some answers to their questions first. So I guess I'll just kind of give you the information that I have and then you can decide what you think. So the building is going to be painted. Right now it's like an off-white color and they're proposing like a something, an earth tone color. They haven't shown me a palette of it yet, but a similar, in the same vein as what they have there now. They're going to repair and restripe the parking lot. The only portion that they're
changing when they restripe is to make one of the handicap van striped spaces wide enough to meet current code. I had them compare what's there now with an existing site plan that we have to make sure that they're actually restriping it in accordance with something that we once approved. And I've compared the two, and they're the same, with the exception of once they restripe the handicap lot, the handicap space, there'll be a slight difference, but the number of spaces will be the same. They're doing repairs to the wooden siding, which I would say would fall under the category of general repair and not really subject to site plan review. And the same with the trash enclosure and the handicap ramp. And then we asked about the new pipe bollard covers, whether they would be illuminated, and they said they're not going to be, but they're going to put some like striping. I forget what the term was. Some shiny striping or something on it. And then they're replacing the downspout. They're going to replace existing stop signs with new ones. So I asked them to indicate to me that all of the signs that are on the site now have been approved at one point. They sent me a signage package. I have to look at it. But I was thinking that if I did do an administrative approval, that would be a separate note that any signage needs to go through a sign permit process. Mm-hmm. And then they've sent me a spec of the emergency light, which they're putting by both of their egress doors. So it's going to go in two places. And then the one J, which is one tree will be removed, has actually increased to 5 trees. So I had them verify that they're all going to be outside of the 100-foot wetlands buffer, which they are.
Improved visibility of what?
Some of the trees are in the parking lot islands and are blocking views, like when people are turning in the parking lot.
So why don't they just
trimming. So they're trimming some and they're removing some, but I can follow up with them and ask for more details.
Yeah, because likely if there was a site plan for that building at some point, my guess is that planting those trees were part of that site plan requirement.
The site plan that I have was from a date I can't read.
1979.
It's over here in this corner in the it's like the late 60s, early 70s or something.
Tiny supermarket. Therefore, when it became Rite Aid, that would have been 1994, 95.
Well, do you want to come look through the files? Try to find a site plan? So what was it called, the supermarket?
Saratani's.
Saratani's.
C-E-R-R-A-T-I.
Okay, so maybe I'll look for that tomorrow and see if I can find it. But
so personally, everything on that list looked to me like maintenance activities, except for
trees.
Removing trees and the adding of the emergency lighting. Although that's probably more of a, I don't know, Nick, more
it's
of a
code,
more of a code issue. But I would think that we would want to ask them more about
sheet.
The tree removal.
Okay.
And get right. I don't know where that lighting's going.
I can show you.
Section, but
I can show you. Hold on.
You don't want those. I assume it's some ugly wall pack type that.
It's not that one.
More and more they're using these LEDs that are either pointing straight down.
Yeah.
It's a little more attractive.
This is where they're putting them. So, of course, this isn't related to
which is the front.
That's the front on the right. Right, isn't it the drive-through at the bottom?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And there's probably an egress door in the back.
Yeah,
which isn't
a big deal.
No.
It's just that one on
the
front.
It's
probably not that big of a deal.
There's probably one there now.
Yeah.
That they're replacing.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Do you want to see the spec of the light? I have it right here. Emergency light with battery backup. Yeah, it is. Okay, another question.
So ultimately, the question that, the question is, are we comfortable having this approved administratively, or do we want them to come before us?
I don't care if they come in front of me to do it, but I'd be opposed to them taking down trees.
Okay.
Probably just limb them up. There's no reason to see that. You can see that building, you can see that sign.
Right.
And I don't think I've ever had a problem moving around it with my.
This is where the trees are gonna be taken from. Let me just fix, so. Looks like they're trimming, removing. So that's, so that, that, this is conflicting, because they told me one, now they're saying two here, and then the tree guy that keeps calling me is saying it's five, so I'll have to clarify that. Seven different people are contacting me about this.
That's all about just being able to see the front of the
building. Seven people.
That's,
I'm like, and then I'm emailing them all back, CCing them all, so they can all get on the same page. It's fun.
Well, the board is basically saying no removal of trees. Trimming is fine.
Trimming is fine.
Okay.
So-called raise the canopy.
See, if there was an open lot here, if this was a plowing issue, for example, there was no island, but there's a constructed island here, so they can't even just plow, you know, through there. Right, if it was all just striped, they're removing this one so they could just plow easier, maybe you'd be more amenable to it. There's an island there.
Let me
and
see,
this
there's
is
a
the
picture.
Nicest part of the whole area. I think that, you know,
yeah.
The train
it
is the only piece of pot in that corner.
All right. Got what you need, Julie?
Nice. I was going to show you one of the picture of the. No, that's not it. Yeah, I have what I mean.
Okay.
I'll follow up with them about that.
Cool.
So that's going to be done administratively.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. I just saw a whole list in my email today. Running between meetings, I'm like, that looks like a lot of stuff. Let's talk about it tonight.
Pretty minor stuff.
Do we want to just bang out these minutes? Because they're not going anywhere.
I looked at them and didn't have any comments except for one word on the fourth.
Which?
I think it's the minutes for the fourth. Is that right?
Sorry, what did you say?
You didn't provide us with the minutes, so I don't have it in front of me.
But I did.
No, it's just one.
So, should we do the ones from April 11th first?
That's
sure. April 7th?
April 11th.
April 11th, right?
Yeah. I reviewed these and I didn't have any comments.
Yeah, that wasn't the one then.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of April 11th, 2016.
Second.
All those in favor?
That was hard.
I realized today that I referenced the wrong Supreme Court justice in my speech to town meeting. It was Alito. Scalia.
I'm sure no one
You
knows.
Know what? Nobody. I didn't even notice.
No.
I was like, sounds good.
I'm like, Samuel Alito? That's not who it was. And then I went into the quick Google search.
Well, it was Thomas that wrote the majority opinion.
Right.
And Alito came out and said, this is how this applies to the other cases related to signs.
And I said that it was Scalia.
Yeah. Well.
He's not going to get mad at
it. Yeah, no.
You got away with it.
Okay, so 3-7 and 3-21 minutes.
Yeah. Which one? I had a question on one. I didn't even bring it with me.
I didn't have that one. Tell me.
Yeah.
Was it the,
I don't know.
Yeah, they were on the Google Drive, but I...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, so, Jeff, your question was on the 3-7 minutes on, page 2. It was about the, what we were just talking about.
Yeah. I just didn't understand the paragraph.
Yeah. So...
Can you just read it?
So, this is what it says. Mr. Miare's... It's like the fourth paragraph down on page 2. Mr. Miare's also noted that the majority opinion written by Justice Clarence Thomas does not refer to any previous Supreme Court cases, and thus it is unclear exactly whether those cases are still considered good law or not.
Hmm. That's which cases?
The cases that the Supreme Court had weighed relating to signs before this one. He didn't reference any of those. He just wrote like a brand new opinion, like they'd never talked about signs before.
Okay.
So this could be clarified, definitely.
Yeah, because you're saying that there are no cases referenced, but then...
Decision.
Right. Yeah, no, I get it now. I just think that it could be a little bit clearer in the
yep.
paragraph. So that's it. Okay, I get it now. Thank you.
And you had one more comment on these two, Jeff, didn't you?
I did.
I don't remember which one that was.
It probably wasn't that big of a deal. I'm exhausted.
Two.
I don't remember.
It's all right.
Okay.
So which ones?
So that was 3.7.
Okay. You want to do that one?
Move that the CPVC approve the minutes for the meeting of March 7th, 2016, as amended, or if amended.
they are not being amended, right?
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, yeah, she's going to make some changes to that paragraph.
As amended,
yeah.
Second.
All those in favor?
Okay, and one more, 3.21.
I don't have any comments on this.
Move that the CPVC approve the minutes for the meeting of March 21st, 2016.
All those in favor?
All right.
Anything else? Any updates or anything?
You know that Portland Pie closed.
Yep.
And we've been in touch with both the property owner and Portland Pie. And so obviously they want to get it leased out. It's a big space with a big rent. So whoever goes in there, assuming another food business goes in, they're going to have to do a volume business to generate enough sales to cover that rent and everything else. So, and Professor's Market opened. I don't know if anybody's been down there. Very
yeah.
nice. They did a beautiful job.
Did you go up there for lunch today?
Yep. It's really good. Orange Leaf is not coming back. They are closed, even though the sign says closed for the season. And Diamici's is going to carry ice cream. So they're introducing that into their product line.
Are they next door?
They're next door, yep.
They could expand.
They talked about it, but they're going to do it this way instead.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
I like that.
Try and kind of give it a test run.
Yeah. Anything with Walgreens?
We haven't heard much. We haven't heard anything. Nope. Walgreens.
Post office?
What?
Post office is in the works, but it's still highly confidential.
But there's progress being made that you've heard of?
Yes.
Super.
But like all things related to the federal government, I couldn't swear that it'll definitely happen, but people are working very hard to see if they can make it happen.
And that includes the parking areas?
I'm not sure. I'm not really sure how far back it goes. And the zoning board takes up Reading Village again Thursday night. I'm going to start a little early at 6:30 and talk about everything you ever wanted to know about the 40B process.
Well, not everything, because I had to cut out half the slides.
Except for the ones Julie cut out, you'll know everything.
Those are just big holes.
We're trying to condense it into a nice tight package. We think there's going to be something coming. We haven't seen anything, but at the last meeting, the applicant indicated they would be taking another pass at the plan. And that one as well has had lots of stuff going on in the background that I cannot disclose. but lots of people trying to do lots of things to make it a better project.
Good.
So, mostly behind the scenes stuff.
Yeah. However it needs to happen, make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
It's good.
It is sensible.
All right, anything else?
That's it for me.
Right. Move to adjourn.
Oh, yeah.
Those in favor?
Hi, Mr.
Thanks, folks.